It's time for Twit This Week in Tech. Oh, my goodness. Get your dunce caps on. I'm sorry. I'll wear the dunce cap. You wear the thinking cap because we've got the smartest panel we've had in a long time. Joining us, Steve Kovach from techinsider.io, Om Malik from om.co, and from Stratechery, the brilliant Ben Thompson. We're going to talk about Facebook. We're going to talk about Twitter. We're going to talk about the Amazon brick-and-mortar store. Om gets the prize for getting that one right 2 years ago, and a lot more. It's all coming up next on Twit.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for This Week in Tech is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com. This is Twit, This Week in Tech, episode 535, recorded Sunday, November 8th, 2015. VR PR. This Week in Tech is brought to you by Audible.com. Sign up for the Platinum Plan and get two free books. Go to audible.com/twit2 and don't forget to follow Audible on Twitter. User ID audible_com. And by Braintree. Looking to set up payments for your business? Braintree gives your app or website a payment solution that accepts just about every payment method with one easy integration. Plus, Braintree will give you the first $50,000 in transactions fee-free. To learn more, visit braintreepayments.com/twit. And by FreshBooks, the super simple cloud accounting software that's giving thousands of freelancers and small businesses the tools to save time billing and get paid faster. Try it free at freshbooks.com/twit. And by Squarespace. Squarespace is the best way to create a beautiful website or online store. Enter the offer code TWIT and get 10% off. Squarespace, build it beautiful. It's time for Twit, This Week in Tech, the show where we cover the latest tech news of the week. Boy, we have the smartest panel ever. I want to pick something. I'm going to have to pick topics that are going to challenge the big brains in the room today. Starting on my left from Business Insider and more recently techinsider.io, Stephen Kovach is here. It's great to have you, Stephen. Welcome back.
Hey, thanks for having me again.
The new techinsider.io is a tech-focused spinoff of Tech Insider, of Business Insider. And you are the, what is your title? Big Shot.
Deputy editor.
Deputy dog. Big Shot. That's nice. I really like this. It's very personable, which is fun. The Apple music books are piling up and it's infuriating. Science says parents of successful kids have these seven things in common. Twitter just showed some new footage from the Star Wars movie. People upset with Starbucks red cups. Come up with a bizarre... I cannot not click on that. Come up with a bizarre way not to fight back. I cannot, but I'm gonna hold off because I still have to introduce the rest of the panel. To my right, Om Malik of Om.co, founder of GigaOm. He's an investor and just the sweetest guy in tech. And everybody loves Om. Om Sweet Om, they call him.
Hi, Leo.
Hi, Om.
How are you doing?
Great. And then finally from Stratechery, and I've been meaning to talk to you, Mr. Ben Thompson, Stratechery.com from Taiwan. I saw that the president of Taiwan and the president of China met.
Yes, they did.
Yeah. Can't wait. That's exciting.
It's interesting.
I thought that would never happen. I'm surprised. But, well, you know, that's good. Why are people upset with the red cups? I have to ask that now.
Oh, because it doesn't have any Christmas stuff on it. It's just plain red. And so some Christian Starbucks customers are going in and saying their name is Merry Christmas. So they have to write Merry Christmas on the cup. And then some guy made a video of it and went crazy viral on Facebook. And
please.
And next thing you know, it's a trending topic on Twitter and Facebook. And it was a big deal this weekend.
This actually is just confirmation of something I've been thinking a lot about lately, which is the total trivialization of everything we care about in the world. We become a nation of, what do you think about this, Oma? It's like, there are serious things going on in the world, and somebody's worried that the Christmas decorations aren't on Starbucks red cups, really. And it's not even the fact that somebody's worried about that, because one person might be worried about that, but that it becomes a thing thanks to Twitter, and now it's everywhere.
I think there is more of everything, whether it's more of cable TV, more of publications, more of social networks, and everybody needs to fill the airtime, the equivalent of airtime. And so they'll talk about just about anything.
That's what it is. You're right.
Yep.
There's not enough to talk about. There's not enough material to fill all the empty airwaves. So you gotta come up with this crap.
You talk about this versus talking about the refugee crisis.
Right.
And guess which one people want to read? Stuff which doesn't take a lot of...
Right.
You know, thinking. And this stuff doesn't take a lot of thinking. It's just talking.
Yeah. No, that's true. That's a good point. So that's why the New York Times is sending this out with each and every Sunday Times today. This being the cardboard, Google Cardboard. It even says Google on it, which is their viewer, their virtual reality viewer. And on the Times Magazine, they says virtual reality, the storyteller's newest tool. Did anybody watch the video?
Yeah, I watched it yesterday. I checked it out a little bit. It's pretty neat.
I'm a little mystified, to be honest with you. So the news story, by the way, there's ads. There's an ad for a Cooper, and there's a General Electric ad among the other videos you can watch. But the story is about the displaced, which is their cover story on the New York Times Magazine on the displaced children of war. 30 million children displaced in their homes, and these are the story of three of them.
Can I actually ask one question?
Yeah.
Which I haven't seen this. How much did Google pay them to put this all out?
Good question. I figured that GE, which is branded right on there, has an ad in there. And Cooper, the Minis, and by the way, the Minis, I thought at first, because there's a URL here which brings you to the Minis ads, and I thought that that was the content, but it's actually just an ad for the Minis. So these guys, I think, are paying a lot. This is an incredible revenue opportunity, clearly, for the New York Times.
I think it would be interesting to ask them the question, especially the media writers should ask them this question, is would they have sent out this VR device and VR content for free had it not been sponsored or advertised again?
Right. Well, the cardboard can't cost that much. I mean, it's a couple of bucks worth of paper. It's literally cardboard. But you make a good point. Actually, this is somewhat of an upgraded cardboard because it has a little bit of a metal clip here. And I think what's interesting to me, yeah, you're right. I think you're right. I think it's a revenue opportunity. Is it the storyteller's newest tool? I don't know. My biggest concern is that for a lot of people, this is going to be their first experience of, and it's not VR, it's immersive video. It's kind of depressing, frankly. I'll be honest with you. It immerses you in a very sad, very, very sad story. As I feel like that VR is really more about entertainment than it is about news. How important is it that we be in the middle of this video if it's news? Ben, what do you think about this? You write about this kind of stuff all the time, I know.
Well, I think it's maybe selling the New York Times a bit short to presume that this is, they're just doing it because they got paid to do it.
Right.
Frankly, the New York Times has impressed me greatly over the last 6 months to a year with a pretty active shift to at least experimentation. I mean, we sit here and we will praise a company like Google or any other cloud services company for doing lots of
right
experiments and tests and seeing what works and what doesn't. And frankly, that's how the New York Times has been behaving lately, whether it be everything from instant articles, whether it be the Google open source, fast article thing, whether it be different aspects of their business model. And so I would actually be, I agree it's a good question to ask, but I'd be inclined to presume they were not paid, but rather trying, just giving it a shot, because they've been first to quite a few things over the last few months.
They certainly understand that digital is the future, right, and not print. And if they're going to succeed, they have to succeed in a digital world. This is, I think it's interesting. I'm glad they did it.
I'm going to take a contrary position on this. I'm going to say this, they're trying out a lot of new things, but this is the same company which can't bring performance to its own apps. They can't bring rationalization to its pricing. It can't bring rationalization to its login schemes. So instead of trying to do VR, I think fixing their current, products and make them more comfortable to use for existing paying customers, like, for example, like me, would be a good use of their technology chops. And now my question is, Google and Facebook and Twitter and every other company in tech tries new experiments without anyone or any clarity on what the business model is going to be. I am asking the question of New York Times is, would they have done this on their own dime, or did they do this because they had advertising? And I think if they did just because of advertising, they get less credit than versus if they were just going to do it on their own. That's more experimentation. This is just a revenue generation scheme.
Well, I don't see it as a scheme. I mean, revenue generation, that's part of the challenge in innovating in journalism and digital right now, is figuring out these new revenue streams, right? I mean, they can't sell enough ads in print anymore. The paywall only does so much. So this is the new revenue stream itself is an experimentation. So I think it's really interesting. They said, hey, we have the resources to do this. And by the way, GE and Google, two brands that want to be tied with innovation and storytelling, would be happy to give us money to help support this project. That in itself is a really interesting way to experiment with new advertising models. So I'm all for this. I think it's great. And I agree with Ben too. They probably would have done it without GE helping them out.
Steve, I'm going to say this, you're very young, so you haven't seen this movie play out before. They used to do the same thing for CD-ROMs, and that was a lot of talk about that.
Oh, yeah.
And other people would underwrite those, and then they would end, like, I can probably still find about 50 of those, like, music magazines, CD-ROMs, which are hanging around my place. But essentially what I'm saying is that experimentation and innovation, I'm absolutely in favor of. I just think sometimes because it is, Google is also trying to get some attention for its VR efforts. Let's not forget that, They are getting a little bit pushed aside by the Oculus VR onslaught. So this is a good way for Google to get attention too.
Although, to be fair, you couldn't really bundle an Oculus with the Sunday Times.
Well,
this is cheap. This is the only company that really, this is the only VR that could actually be distributed with the Sunday Times. I now see a lot of Google branding on it. There's Google on the
bottom.
It's mostly GE's got a much bigger brand, and then Cooper on the magazine. It's all about the Coop, the Mini, or whatever it's called.
Go for it, Ben.
I certainly agree. Skepticism is always warranted.
Well, couldn't it be both? Couldn't it be both? This is a great opportunity to make money and a great opportunity to tell news stories in a new and more immersive, engaging way? Couldn't it be both?
Well, when it comes to the business model, actually, the New York Times has gotten a lot of clarity about it. I mean, they recently passed 1 million digital subscribers, which is, regardless of your opinion of their apps or their payment options, which I agree are very frustrating, particularly the way they kind of obscure it. But that's still very, very impressive. And they had a new strategy memo that came out about a month ago, basically saying that they are going to double down on that strategy. And I think that's actually a really encouraging sign, in that, it's very dangerous for any business to be stuck in the middle. And for them to be clear that our focus is going to be on subscriptions, they want to double their revenue there, including both new subscribers, but also increasing revenue from their current subscribers. I like the clarity of their thinking around that. And like I said, it's in line with a lot of the other stuff they're doing. At the same time, the trouble with subscription business, and I know this very well, is getting new subscribers. It's getting new people. It's figuring out why people should care. And the fact that And this actually, again, I think it's very clearly an experiment, but it does fit with that. One, it's a benefit for subscribers only. So you're getting something for being a subscriber. Two, it's something that certainly gets attention as an opportunity to attract a new audience that's interested in a new form of media. And so, yes, I certainly agree that the company has opportunities to improve, but I think that it's tempting to just kind of lump all journalism institutions in kind of the same boat. And I think, again, I think that's someone who's been a critic of the Times and a lot of stuff they've done. I think over the last few months, they've really shown an impressive clarity of purpose when it comes to their strategy. And I don't think that this is, and I think in some respects, if you look at it that way, this is a better fit than it might seem at first glance.
History's not on their side. The hardest thing in the world is to take an incumbent business like printing a newspaper and moving into the digital.
Oh, it helps when you have no choice.
Well, they have to. And at the same time, I cannot think of any examples. I can think of so many counterexamples, you know, like Kodak, where it's just, even if you saw it coming down the road at you, it's so hard to make that change without cannibalizing your existing business. I think that's the excuse I would give them for their Byzantine subscription model, and Wall Street Journal is similar. It's cheaper to get the paper and the digital version of the Wall Street Journal than just the digital version, for instance.
Same with the Times.
It's so bizarre, but I understand why. They have to somehow make this transition without killing the cash cow. And it feels like the Times, of all the journalistic entities anyway, seems to be doing that the best.
Look, I think no one is saying that they shouldn't experiment. I think experimentation is good. I think you should look at the New York Times Labs is doing interesting stuff. And, you know, that's experimentation. Just nobody talks about this. This one looks like a way for them to capitalize on a hot, trendy thing.
Right.
And make some money on it. Like, I would want to know what the data says about the results of this experiment. How many people actually saw these things? How many people actually, you know, opened the
They'll never tell you because it's got to be a low number, right? You didn't. You get the Sunday Times.
I don't get the Sunday. I mean, I don't pick it up. Like, I am a subscriber, but I don't pick up the paper.
You leave it outside the door for somebody else to get it?
Yeah, somebody else to take it. I mean, then I'll have to get rid of it.
The Salzburger family's so happy to hear that. I have to admit, there's more than a few times I've left that blue-wrapped New York Times, Sunday Times on the driveway to Tuesday. Actually, interestingly, and I don't know if it's a coincidence, normally the guy throws it on the driveway and it gets run over and it gets rained on. Today's Sunday Times was nicely placed on our porch. I think they might have sent out a word to all the delivery guys. This one you want to be a little extra careful with because there's cardboard inside.
Oh, delivery guys don't read that.
As a former paper boy. The memo? Well, why was it so carefully placed on my porch? He's never done. He did that when he first started and then hasn't done it since.
Might be a new guy.
Maybe he's a new guy. It's the new guy.
Or maybe it's his last day on the job.
My only concern, I thought, was that this is going to be people's first exposure to VR. And I'm afraid that they're going to have an indelible impression of sadness because it's a very sad story. It's about three kids who are living in war zones, basically, whose lives have been devastated by war. There's a strange sensation because, in fact, even in one of the scenes, you can see the shadow of it. You know that there's one of these weird 360-degree cameras. There's no reporters in this story. It's all narration over these kids just kind of living their life. But you know that there's this thing in the middle of the recording this $5,000 camera or more in the middle recording this. And you kind of get I always get this feeling with documentaries, too. I always think about the guys out in the wilderness living on worms, except what about the 20-person camera crew that's following him around? And I got this strange sensation that, you know, maybe if you just gave them some money, that would be better than just putting a expensive camera in there and shooting their lives. It's almost voyeuristic. Anyway, those are just a couple of concerns. I think it's good that the New York Times is trying something, and it's going to be, for most people, their first experience of VR, right?
Or some people, not most people.
Aside from the people like us who are obsessed with new technologies, how many people have really had a chance to play with this?
Yeah, I think this is going to be the first exposure for a lot of people. And whether it's true VR or you want to call, immersive video. Or whatever. And also, it wasn't just that one story, that one depressing story. There's a really cool like tour of New York City street art. There's a story on that. And so,
there's a story of a cover that they made. Mm-hmm. But they're really pushing the displaced. So.
And it's its own app. And so, you know, they might do some more in the future. So, but yeah, it does great. It's some great storytelling and it's great exposure to this new technology that many believe is, you know, the next big thing.
You said the digital subscriptions are over 1 million. Do we know how many people subscribe to the newspaper?
Not that it's like 1.1 total combined. So it's a fraction of the amount.
Interesting. All right. I just, you know, in like IDG just closed its last paper magazine, CIO. IDG was what, you know, IDG and Ziff Davis were monsters in technology publishing. Neither of them have paper magazines anymore. We're in a tough time if you're a printer.
Well, this is one of the interesting things about, there was a really good podcast. Sorry, I'm going to name a competitor, I guess, to all of us. The Recode Decode had, or not Recode Decode, the Recode Code Mobile, one of their conferences.
I'm glad to
promote, Code Media, that's what it was.
Promote their stuff. Anybody does a great podcast, we can plug it.
Yeah, it was just listed as a podcast. It was actually a conference talk where Kara Swisher and Peter Kafka interviewed Dean Baquet. And it was really good about quite a few things, including the Amazon story, including a few other things. But one of the points that was interesting to your point, Leo, was about the print thing. And for example, it talked about how the Amazon story, why did it run on a Saturday, which was not your traditional news cycle.
You're talking about the New York Times story about how horrible it was to work at Amazon.
Right. And the reason was so that it would still be fresh when they printed it on the front page of the Sunday paper. And,
isn't that interesting?
Yeah, and he was very honest about it. He's like, it's kind of a silly thing, but the fact of the matter is the Sunday paper is by far our biggest, you know, drives a ton of revenue and a ton of margin.
Steve saw this video yesterday. They were promoting this for a week, and you didn't have to have the paper and the cardboard to see it.
Right, but I think they've calculated that if they put it on Saturday, it'll be fresh enough for their Sunday subscribers. They won't feel they're getting old news. Because apparently what happened with the nail salon story, they ran it during the week as a series on the web and then planned to print it on the Sunday paper, but it got more pickup than they anticipated. And so it ended up being, they felt they had a very stale story for their most profitable customers. And so that went into the thinking of the timing of the Amazon story, which I thought was very interesting. And it really gets at, you know, the trouble they have in this transition that any incumbent company has. At the same time, the benefit they have is they're the New York Times. I mean, you don't get 1 million subscribers, you know, by having a hard to pronounce website name. I can tell you that much.
Om, is one of your problems with the Times these particular stories and the controversy around them, the Amazon story, the nail story, and I'll add the Hillary Clinton email server story. All three of those were at least according to some, misreported by the Times.
Not at all. I have no problems with what they do on a day-to-day basis. I think, thankfully, in last one and a half months, we have seen the return of the classic big publication, you know, stories like which they both the Times and the Wall Street Journal went on investigative story, track and came up with like some really solid, strong stories. You know, everything they do from an editorial perspective is not perfect, but most of the things they do are actually pretty good. If the Times went away, there would be a hole in the universe.
I agree.
So don't get me wrong on that. I'm only making a point about this specific VR-related move of theirs. I think this is less reflective of their innovation and more opportunistic,
So you'd say VR, PR.
Oh, yeah, I think that's a good one. I think the key for me is like, I think the Amazon story, there is no way the New York Times is misreporting a story of that magnitude. You know, the nail salon story. I think they may not be, you know, talking about things which seem, you know, perfect or realistic at times, but as a publication, They just are very solid and deep, and I quite enjoy. I mean, I can't emphasize, my day would be incomplete if the Times wasn't there. Whether I wake up to read their tech coverage, probably not. Do I wake up to read John Markoff? 100%.
Yeah.
Do I wake up to read their foreign service, foreign reports? Absolutely. Their features? Absolutely. So I think
Go ahead. No, please continue.
But I was saying was that as a publication, both, they and Wall Street Journal have been doing some really strong stories. I think the stories, when they are not, they're not the stories which are like, acceptable to a certain part of, let's say, Silicon Valley. The Toreno story exposed certain, like flaws in how we value in companies and how we write about them and how we talk about them and the fetishization of startups. And so it kind of was jarring for all of us in the entire ecosystem, whether you're a commenter, investor, blogger, whatever. It felt like, whoa, where did this come from? And I think that's what big publications can do, take 8, 9, 10 months to investigate deep, stories which actually need, closer look. I think Amazon was one of those things. I think the
third. You don't think it has anything to do with the fact that Bezos bought the Washington Post?
Come on. That just is like an insane argument to make. I think that's got nothing to do with it.
Okay.
I was going to apologize for trying to jump in, and I jumped in again.
No, it's hard because I know you're all on Skype. It makes it, and I should apologize to the listeners at home because everybody's on Skype. The latency makes it difficult. Go ahead, Ben.
No, I wanted to jump in. I was so enthusiastic because I just wanted to 100% agree with Om. That's what made the whole thing so tragic. I mean, the reality is, as much as this pains people, and I've heard from people, saying like, why, we're trying to do good things, we're trying to change the world, blah, blah, blah. Well, I mean, the more you want to change the world, and two, the more you have the capacity to change the world, the more oversight is necessary.
Yes.
I mean, all the people who really screwed things up were trying to change the world. And given the amount of power that tech is accruing, thanks to internet economics and the way it works and the way it makes the big get bigger, I completely agree that this focus of the Times and the Journal recently is very much appreciated. And another thing from that interview was saying that we're going to actually focus less on day-to-day stuff, less than all the news that's fit to print sort of idea, because there's no market for that anymore.
Right.
You can get that easily, but spend more time on these sorts of things. And I think that's a great thing.
That's, by the way, what we do too, because I'm not going to be able to compete against a blog that can publish every 5 minutes. So
5 minutes, that's slow.
I mean, that's really an excellent point.
I'm sorry for interrupting. You had me so eager to agree with you, I swear.
That was fine.
We all agree with them.
No.
And we'd be fools to disagree.
No, we should disagree. Otherwise.
But, we were talking, I can't remember, I think it was before the show started, but we were talking about the trivialization of story. I guess it was during the show, of the stories that, thanks to the drive to create links and social media, that just a vast amount of trivial stuff that hits the front pages. It's nice to have somebody doing what Stephen Levy calls slow news. The Times did a story, controversial though it was, about a guy who died alone, and it was an immensely researched, a year in the making story that only a big organization like the Times could really do, I think.
Agree. That was a pretty another example of, a big publication doing a big story. Yeah. I think, which is why, their value doesn't go away. Their value only grows with time, especially.
That's what they need to focus on, in my opinion.
I think they can't be in the middle, in my opinion. And I think they're right by focusing on the big stories. Yeah. I think that's what gets people talking. But then they cover, America pretty well. I mean, even though a lot of people disagree with their politics, and they still cover the day-to-day of America pretty well. I forget the politics part. You don't have to agree with that. They have some good, you know, coverage of a lot of.
The Times states. Is the only news organization that has a large widget on the front page of my phone, or the one of the pages of my phone.
No, I think if you actually sit down and go through, I mean, this is I'm just turning to quite a pen to the New York or to the New York Times, but I mean, if you go through and just consider the incredible volume of very high quality content that comes out every day, it's pretty phenomenal. Yeah. And again, that's what makes me so encouraged. I'm being a bit of contrarian. I think I would probably agree with Om that this VR thing is more of a publicity stunt than anything. But that said, my points about them having much more clarity in their strategy and being focused on being super highly differentiated and doing the stuff that only they can do and then charging people for that, I think it's encouraging. And it's encouraging because we need institutions like the Times. And again, do they get everything right? No, they don't. But the reality is no newspaper has ever gotten anything right. It just so happened they were the only source before, and right. So everyone kind of just presumed it was right. And yeah, and that's an adjustment for them as well, to know that they're not the only source of truth. And go back to the Amazon thing, that's why I thought it was so great that Paquette responded on Medium to the Amazon PR guy. I mean, because that's the whole point. What was so hard, I think, for the Times for a very long time to adjust to was appreciating that news can happen that isn't in the New York Times. And it might never be in the New York Times. And that doesn't mean it's a small story. Like that whole phrase, all the news that's fit to print, was so limiting in a way. And I think they've really moved past that in a very real way, and in a way that makes sense in an environment where you don't have a geographic monopoly. You don't have a moat built on distribution. You competing with everyone on the internet. And that means you do have to be focused and you have to do what you do best. And it's good. It's good for them, and it's good for tech. I mean, be prepared. I'm pretty sure there's gonna be more of these sorts of stories coming. And frankly, we're all big boys and big girls. Like, we can deal with it. And as an industry, collectively, should welcome it.
Well, certainly done. You know, more to expose immersive video and VR than anybody's done to this date. So.
And Om, you
have to acknowledge that they should be looking at innovative ways to monetize as well, because if they don't monetize, they can't do the long-form reporting either. They go hand in hand.
Yeah, I think there's you can spin an angle here, but frankly, I'd probably have to agree with them.
I don't want to, by the way, make this a journalism panel, but later in the show, I want to talk to you about your Grantland piece, because, Ben, I thought that was really awesome, and I agree with you 100%.
And I can give my defense about why I do write about particularly print media. I'll make it right now. Like, the reason why I find writing about print media so fascinating is it's not because I compete in that industry, although as any human, I'm sure that plays a role. But it's that text is perfect. Text perfectly translated from analog to digital. Like
no bits were lost.
No, exactly. Like, text is the fundamental structure of code and all that sort of thing. Well, it's ones and zeros, but you get what I'm saying. And what's interesting about that is that meant the effects of the internet, the effects of there being zero distribution, of your ability to have basically zero transaction costs and to manage a huge customer base in a way that wasn't possible before, that manifested itself, the impacts of that manifested itself in print way faster than any other industry. And so immediately you had this very jarring sort of disruption going on. And so, one, if you can understand what happened to newspapers, what happens when the distribution limiting function goes away, like how does things fall apart in interesting ways? That's actually something you start thinking about when it comes to other industries, whether that be the transportation industry, whether that be the hotel industry, whether that be the video industry. And then on the flip side, if you can start to think about what business models might emerge from this, like how can you actually build a business, then again, that might be a clue for how you can build a business in other industries once they've been all sort of messed up. And it's kind of the purity of the fact that text was just so perfectly translated, which meant it experienced all these issues far before anyone else, that I find it so fascinating to think about and write about from a business perspective, because I think the lessons will ultimately be broader than just you know, the future of the New York Times.
Yeah, I think it's a crucible. It's a test tube for everything that's about to come.
I think the way to think about this is, like, remember back in mid-90s, we had the brokerages where you had to call a broker and you know, put your trades through. And then the discount brokers came, and then the internet brokers came, and the game changed. That's exactly the... And then there was a couple of, you know, homes, like banks like Goldman and JP Morgan, which were all about quality and, you know, client services and stuff like that. And they scaled up, you know, with a lot of help from the government. And then there was a whole bunch of, like, online discount, you know, stock brokerages. And I think media is going through the same cycle. In fact, all industries will go through the same cycle. You're either going to end up in the low-cost, high-volume business, or you're going to end up in the premium business. If you're in the middle, you're just going to get killed. There will be no room. Remember all those firms like Merrill Lynch and, you know, I can't even remember half their names. They're just gone.
The street like corner brokerages.
You know, Morgan yeah. Kidder and this, more, yeah. and you know, all those, like Prudential, everything is just gone. Like yeah. that, what's left is, you know, the E-Trades of the world and Schwab's of the world on one end. And then you have guys like JP Morgan and Goldman Sachs. So what's happened is there is going to happen in every industry. And media, it's being played out right in front of us right now. Like you can see the scale guys are just winning, right? Like they're going away with all the revenue is going to those guys. And then, and on the other hand, some people are bulking up. BuzzFeed is a good example. Vice is another example of that. You know, video, they're using video and premium kind of experiences and building, you know, their businesses on top of it. So I think it's an interesting time in media landscape too. And, you know, I think Ben is right when he says that this is going to have a knock-on effect in every other industry. Like, I'm actually interested in seeing and knowing what industries he thinks will be impacted next.
Well, the other thing that's great about media is that we can see it happen visibly, very visibly happen. You know, what's going on to the real estate brokers of the world, I don't know, but I can tell what's going on in the New York Times and other newspapers. We got to take a break. What a great panel. And I'm thrilled to have you all. Stephen Kovach from techinsider.io, from Stratechery, Ben Thompson, Om Malik, who's just from Om. Om's that's him. He's it. He's the guy right there. And we're glad to have you along for the ride. Our show today brought to you by audible.com. I've got two free books for you. The real challenge with the Audible is, which books? 180,000 titles, bestsellers, science fiction, of course, great tech titles as well. I was just looking. I just published a blog post with every Audible book I own and highlighted kind of the ones that I liked a lot. And I realized, boy, there's a lot of tech titles that I read and listen to on Audible that are just great. If this is the kind of conversation you like to have, The Innovators, the Walter Isaacson book, and, of course, his previous book, Steve Jobs. Ashley Vance's great book on Elon Musk, but then classics, you go back in time and Hackers and some of those great Stephen Levy books. There's also a lot of wonderful fiction and history and, like I said, science fiction. I want you to visit audible.com. Actually, let me give you the URL. You can get two books free. You'll be signing up for the Platinum account. That's two books a month, plus the Daily Digest of the New York Times or the Wall Street Journal. And all of that's available to you for free for the first 30 days. That means you get two books or a two-credit book, because some books are two credits, but 90%, 99% are single credit. So most likely you're going to get two books. And then cancel in the first 30 days. You'll pay nothing. Those books are going to be yours to keep. But I got to tell you, this is one of those things where, for some of you at least, you're going to get hooked. The new Stephen King story collection is amazing. Narrated, different story. Each story has a different narrator, so it's a great way to kind of hear the variety and range of narrators. Unlike reading a book, listening to a book really is a lot about the narrator. And having a great narrator can really bring a book alive. So it's a good idea to think about that. In fact, one of the nice things with Audible is you can always listen to a preview of any book. So I recommend you do that when you're picking your books. This is these are the high-performing narrators. I have to agree, 11-22-63 was an amazing book. I Am Malala. The Goldfinch, I loved that. Great narrators bring a book alive. This is a wonderful one. This is The Help, which is dramatized by several women, including Octavia Spencer. What a great novel. If you saw the movie, don't judge it by the movie, which was a great movie, but you got to read the novel. So here's the deal. Go to audible.com/twit and the number 2. Get signed up for that Platinum account. Your first month's free. Get 2 books. I know, it's not easy to pick. I'm listening to an amazing book. I'm going to give a plug to this. It's called The Righteous Mind. It's a little deceiving. I got this. My dad recommended it, and I got it, and I didn't listen to it for a long time because I thought it was about what it said it was about, why good people are divided by politics and religion. It's not about that at all. It's about moral psychology and how we gain a moral compass, what it is and when it is that we learn our ethics. Is it by our parents teaching us? Is it in our genes? And how do we come to moral conclusions? And how do they differ across culture? It's actually fascinating. Jonathan Haidt, the author, is a professor at UVA, where he's done a lot of work on this. One of the best known moral psychologists. So I'm just giving a little plug for that. That's what I'm listening to right now. Audible.com/twit2. Your first 2 books are free. Good luck picking. But here's the good news. The following month, you get 2 more books. And forever. I think when I look at twitter.com/moments, the Twitter moments feed, that's when I say, thank God there's the New York Times, because it's just terrible. You guys agree? This is Twitter's newest product. The first thing that happened under Jack Dorsey's leadership.
To be fair, I think it was Dick Costolo's project.
Oh, yeah. I mean, it had been around for a while. Yeah. I think Jack was the one who said, hey, can you get that out of the labs?
Yeah, it's annoying, and that stupid blue dot. I'm so anal about my notifications, and I just I've kind of had to train myself to ignore it. It's basically useless. I never find myself looking at that moment saying, I get my news from my Twitter feed. I have great lists, and I follow great people, and that's the best way to get your news on Twitter, not from these. Yeah. It's just not well curated, and you never know what's going on.
Someone saying that I have a great curated Twitter feed and I get my news from Wiss and all these sorts of things.
So much work, though. That's years of work.
Right. Decrying moments is arguably an argument in favor of moments. Right.
Yeah, but it's terribly done. If it was done well, then of course, but it's not done well.
I would argue that anyone that has done that much work with Twitter is not in a position to judge whether it's done well or not.
It's for the newbie is what you're saying.
For the news. Well, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, the reality is we know exactly how far the current Twitter experience will get you. And right. It will get you reportedly 300 million monthly active users. I'm curious how big that number actually is for people actively, looking at Twitter and not
right.
bots or accidentally logging on or things like that. And the other problem with Twitter is Twitter works well as a brand advertising platform, but 300 million just isn't large enough, frankly, which is kind of amazing, but it's not. And 300 million is definitely plenty big to do a nice direct response platform, but the actual format of a feed where it's flowing by quickly isn't great for direct response. So they have a real mismatch when it comes to their business models and their kind of canvas. And again, I generally think moments is nice. I think it's a lot nicer if you're a sports fan because I think the sports moments are by far the most compelling. I certainly agree it has lots of problems, but the fact that it's not at all like the regular Twitter experience is, in the absence of all other countervailing evidence, a plus in my mind.
I have to confess, the only time I ever see it is during these shows when we talk about it, because I try to avoid it otherwise.
Yeah, I have written relatively in favor of it, and I'm kind of annoyed by that post actually, because I'm one of the longest running Twitter bears. I wrote at the time they filed their S1 prospectus. I'm like, this company has a massive problem on their hands, and it's not looking good.
Do you feel they've turned it around? Do you think Jack's done a good job of?
No, I don't think they turned it on at all. And that's where I'm kind of annoyed at the way my post was interpreted, which is my fault.
You said it's always darkest before the dawn. This is Twitter's moment.
Well, yeah, I know. Like I said, I got a little worked up. The reason why I'm encouraged is because what I see in moments, what I see in other things, what I see in other things that are happening on Twitter is at least a recognition that they have a problem. And frankly, they're...
Well, I think the market kind of forced them to recognize you that, would, don't you think?
You would think so. But Leo, that homepage of Twitter with like the rotating three quip art images, was the homepage of Twitter for over 3 years.
Yeah.
And when I talk about this advertising problem, there being a mismatch between the sort of advertising products they can offer and the canvas they can offer them on, this is all intertwined. A stagnating product isn't just a problem from a user perspective. It's a problem from a business model perspective. And frankly, it boggled the mind. It still boggles the mind how little the product evolved over years. And frankly, it's like an alcoholic's sort of thing. Just recognizing you have a problem is right. 50% of
the
battle.
First step.
Exactly. And at least it seems like they recognize they have a problem. They have massive issues in overcoming that problem. One, the brain drain issue is a huge problem. Like, why would you want to go work there? Or why would you want to stay? Two, there's this real mismatch. And you see this with moments, not to pick on Steve, but there's this on one hand, they have people who love Twitter and never want it to change. And that's their biggest strength, is they have this built-in user base that's fanatical about the product. And on the other hand, they have four times the number of people who have tried the product and decided it's not for them. And to get those people back is massively difficult, independent of the fact that anything you do to get them back is going to really annoy the other group. I mean, they're just in a really tough spot. And frankly, the
American presidential election, which is going to is in full gear and is another year to run, is an opportunity for Twitter to shine.
Maybe. I mean, frankly, I think Facebook is going to dominate. Well, I mean, for a few reasons. One, that's where people are, particularly the part of the electorate that needs to be reached by a political campaign. Two, the infrastructure Facebook has in place to support politics is very impressive. They have a fully built out team that basically is nonpartisan, and it's available to any elected candidate. It will go and teach you how to do Facebook, what to do, wow, how to do ads, how to do the sort of things. And it's worldwide. They fly all over the world helping candidates in elections all over the world. And they're gearing up and they're staffing up hugely for the U.S. election. And then three, I mean, they have an advertising product that works, that fits well with the platform. I think it's one of the best advertising products in tech. It literally takes over the screen of the device you're looking at, and no advertising in tech has done that before. And so, I think they're going to have a huge election season. And,
you know, I don't see much political content on Twitter. I mean, I see it posted by my friends who are, you know, the left and the right fighting with one another. But I don't see any Ben Carson stuff here. I don't see any Hillary Clinton here. I see it on Twitter. Hillary owns Twitter.
Yeah, Twitter tends to be mostly the coasts and liberal in general. But Ben Carson is dominating Facebook. Actually, a huge amount of his.
But if I don't follow him, I'm not going to see it, right?
Well, but you're. I mean, would it be smart? Would it be worthwhile for Ben Carson to target you?
Right. No.
I mean, that's the power. That's the power of Facebook and these sort of platforms. And the other. I mean, the thing to keep in mind is.
My understanding of American politics is the way you become president is by winning over the swing voters, not the ones who are already going to vote for you no matter what.
Well, right now he's in the primaries and he's going after the Republicans right now.
Yeah.
So it makes sense. And I mean, he's attributed to Facebook.
His success is attributed to Facebook.
Yes.
Partly. Yeah. He's already said that.
I got to follow him. If I like Dr. Ben Carson, what's going to happen to my Facebook feed?
Yeah, no.
Oh, God.
Is something weird going to happen? Oh, hey, first of all, this is interesting. This is the new thing, right? You can have a sign up button or a, look at this, sign up. That's different from, I mean, there's a like button. What happens when I sign up? That takes me out to his site.
You just gave him money.
Yeah. Wow. Just like that. It was that easy. So, and look at timeline about donate. Twitter, and more. This is interesting. So this is Facebook really reaching out. I'm sure if I go to Hillary Clinton, I'll see something similar, right?
Yeah, no, Facebook's very non-objective about it.
Oh, yeah, they don't care.
Well, they will care about the impact it will have on their bottom line. Also,
Hillary has signed up, but she hasn't figured out how to put a donate button there in between the about and photos. Interesting. What do you think, Om? Where do you come down? Twitter, Facebook?
On what?
I'll jump in. Oh, there he is.
Do you have an opinion on what we're talking about here? Or just giving you a chance to say something.
No, I think Ben has strong opinions about Twitter. He's right. I think my piece on Twitter, which was about all the challenges it faces, is like manifold. I think not only Facebook is very strong, it also has competition for attention from Instagram and Snapchat and a whole bunch of other things. So the task is much more difficult for them than most people actually realize. Now, on the good news side, you actually have a CEO who's comes from the product background, who was a co-founder. He has the moral authority to make tough decisions inside the company. And so I'm actually more hopeful about Twitter making some kind of comeback than most people. And purely based on the fact that we finally have somebody who cares about the product,
right,
who cares about the users, who cares about the experience. And, you know, it's not something which can happen in 3 months or 5 months. This is going to happen over, you know, 12 months at the very least. You know, there's a lot of articles people write about Twitter. It's like whether it's decaying, it's dying, whatever. Man, the one thing from the day I first covered Twitter till today, that company knows how to make a comeback. It just keeps coming back. I don't know how they have the ability to reinvent themselves right now. I think with Jack in charge, they will figure out a game plan.
Meanwhile, Jack's other company, Square, is going down, baby.
Well, just a second. I just wanted. I mean,
okay. Go ahead, and we'll go to Square later. Go ahead.
I'm glad I said that. And again, this is just an agreement fest. But I think that's exactly right. I mean, you can't. The whole thing about Twitter, and there's like, it's a company that's kind of a ridiculous company from the get-go, and they've overcome so much obstacles, most of them self-generated. But there's something meaningful to that, and I know like Dorsey previously has invited the sort of Steve Jobs comparisons, but I mean there's a like all these sorts of like ridiculous things there's some grain of reality in them, and man, I hope that it ends up being a repeat. The only thing I would add, though, is we in tech way overvalue, I think, the impact of Twitter. I mean, Facebook is responsible for 79% of social referrals. Number two is not Twitter. It's Pinterest with 16%, and Twitter has 3%. So even though we all live on Twitter, and so we act like it's an equivalent to Facebook, when it comes to a political campaign or an advertiser and figuring out where to focus your time, it's really not even in the conversation. And that's the big, you know, that's a big part where all our discussions, I think, tend to warp the reality of the challenge they face.
What about this? Go ahead.
That's exactly what makes it interesting, right? Like all the influencers are on Twitter. They're talking to each other, and that gets amplified in other platforms, whether it is print or radio or television or even, you know, other social platforms. So I think what Twitter has is all the media and all the celebrities. I think it's the best vanity platform that is out there.
Vanity is a good word for it. Yeah.
Yeah.
No, that's where the value really is. I mean, because when you think about it, the dispersion of information, Twitter is much closer to the top than Facebook. And I don't have it in front of me, but there's absolutely been studies about that. The stories that blow up, like the BuzzFeed dress story, for example, they did a breakdown of like how the traffic flowed, and it always starts on Twitter. And figuring out how to capture that and give value from that, I think is a thing. But there's something there. That's the thing. There's something there in Twitter, and that's the biggest reason to be encouraged more than anything is like there's something. And yeah, and I'm glad Jack's back. I'm glad to have the authority there. I think, I love how I'm put it. I'm not going to add any more. I think he put it well.
And meanwhile, Snapchat, in terms of videos, closing the gap with Facebook, tripling its video traffic. In fact, the growth has been kind of stunning. Facebook has 8 billion daily video views, although some would dispute what is a view, according to Facebook. Is it 1 second? Is it 2 seconds? Snapchat is saying 6 billion video views. That's 3 times more than it had in May. If I were a candidate running for president, I might look at the Snapchat vote.
Hillary's all over it.
Really?
That's her big thing. She has a great social media team, and Snapchat is one of her...
what do you do on Snapchat right if you're a candidate? Do you do a little policy stories. Statements?
Make stories. I'm a really bad Snapchat user, so I'm at age 30, I'm probably too old for Snapchat.
Yeah.
But she does, from what I've seen, she's done a great job behind the scenes at events and stuff. And their stories are just a great platform for them to share these big videos with people, just blast them out to a bunch of people at once.
Does Snapchat have a way to I would have to search for Hillary Clinton if I wanted to do that.
Yeah, and you follow her just like you'd follow on Twitter or something. Right. And then, whenever they put a story together, you can watch each little update.
I have just followed Donald Trump, Ben Carson, Hillary Clinton, Bernie Sanders on Snapchat. I'm going to do that on Snapchat. I just follow them on Facebook just to see what happens.
Your algorithm, your newsfeed's going to look
like garbage. I just screwed my newsfeed big time.
You should follow Marco Rubio if you...
Really, to get a full, complete experience?
No, he's probably just going to be the nominee.
I'm kind of starting to incline that way. Or maybe Ted. Yeah, I think you're right, yeah. All right, I'll follow. Not Ted.
Oh.
No, Ted's too far to the right. Marco Rubio.
I agree. I do agree with the, I'm not sure who's say this, but that, yeah, the two finalists are probably Cruz and Rubio, though.
Right. All right, I'm liking Marco Rubio. I'm going to have one hell of a feed. And then I'll try to follow them all on Snapchat. But you have to, Snapchat doesn't do any of that. Oh, you might like, because it's really supposed to be personal, right? It's supposed to be.
You have to seek them out.
Yeah.
And that's why I see so many people, to Ohm's point, using Twitter as the starting point and making their little avatar that QR code to follow them on Snapchat where they can get more engagement, which I find pretty funny. A lot of media organizations are doing that too.
How about the Discover thing? Is that still? It seems like that's a really good way to drive traffic. That's for the pro media folks.
It doesn't really drive traffic. These are stories that are native.
I guess it's not. It's native. Snapchat. So it's drive attention, I should say.
Yeah.
Oh, I mean, Snapchat is a behemoth. I mean, these videos are no accident, and it's why. I think that Snapchat. There's a reason why Facebook tried to buy them, and why they feel threatened by them because. And Snapchat, it's interesting because Snapchat is going for scale. Like they're going just straight up for that almost TV straight up replacement sort of brand advertising sort of angle because it's almost valuable in a way. They'll get a better Discover functionality at some point, but for now there's almost some sort of value in that you have sought out what you're, right. what you're going for. Like your, what you have available to view is selective. It's not just filled with a bunch of junk. And when an ad is in there, it's going to stand out more. And then you have the whole sort of like, you have to keep your finger on the screen to keep watching it. Like you're ensuring the likelihood of someone actually knowing that someone's actually viewing what they're looking at is,
you don't have to do that. It's pretty high. They took that out. You don't have to hold it anymore.
You just tap once now.
You're so, no, you're so last week.
I am.
Actually, I was really pleased because I got awfully tired of holding that down. All right, I can apparently swipe right to chat with Hillary Clinton. Let's see if she responds.
Ask her on Twitter. Ask her to Skype in.
Yeah, would you like to join us on... Yeah, that's looks... I don't know. I'm afraid she's going to send me a naked picture. I don't know. This is not what I want to have happen. There should be... I tried to follow her stories, but I didn't get any... That's where she would likely show up, right? Not personal messaging to me.
No, there's little circles below the Discover content.
These are the stories.
Where she'll pop up.
Yeah, like Snappatunde. Baratunde still thinks people are following him on the... That's it. He's really slowed down, though, quite a bit. All right. Interesting. Hillary is, by the way, just Hillary on Snapchat. You search for Hillary Clinton, but then her handle is just Hillary. So it's very intimate. Interesting. I can't find it anymore. I've lost my Snapchat. I wiped this phone off, and now nothing works. All right. Moving right along. I could tell.
We should go back to the Square thing. I think it's interesting.
Let's talk about Square. So Square is a unicorn, right? Valued at $6 billion, except maybe not. The IPO terms are going to put the valuation actually lower than the last funding round, more like $3.9 billion. That's not because Jack is doing double duty as CEO, right?
No.
Most likely that's the bad news from Starbucks, for instance. That Starbucks deal, which was highly touted, was a big flop.
Well, Square has pivoted from being the vision was to be a consumer-focused payments company to being basically a small and medium-sized business infrastructure provider, leveraging their payments right into, you know, management systems and things like that, which in the long run is a more viable market, I think, but a smaller one. I think that's reasonable.
And then look what happens when they try to partner with a big business. The Starbucks deal, which you saw in the S-1, was just a disaster.
Right. They lost money on that after a year. They pulled the plug on it.
Well, I think the way to think about Square or any other service like Square is that, you know, these are companies which are built for today's market demand. For instance, payments today are not the way payments used to be in a 9-to-5 world where the stores would open at a certain time and close at a certain time. The demand and you know, the commerce is a very, it's an unpredictable, very unpredictable activity.
It felt like it was such a powerful, empowering technology that any artist could get a Square thing. And
it is.
And I mean, but why hasn't it exploded as a result?
Okay. It's a $4 billion company. That's not bad.
It's like,
oh, okay. Never mind.
I mean, like, when did that become a bad thing that it's a $4 billion?
No, you're right. Only, okay. Never mind.
Only remember, like, you know, there's people. I recently went to Seattle and visited a company called Filson, which has been in business for close to 120 years. And they're like a $50 million business, for God's sake, you know. A billion is still a billion in the real world.
It's good money.
I think maybe not in Silicon Valley,
right,
but in the real world, billion is a lot of money. I think even a million is a lot of money in the real world. I think we have a very skewed perspective of, you know, what it is. It also doesn't help that we have this, you know, for about 3 years, we had this hype cycle around unicorns. It's like nobody stood there and asked the question. It's like, unicorn is a mythical thing. It doesn't exist. It's like, why would you put your unicorn against your company's name? It's like, it's a myth. So
a unicorn is a company valued at $1 billion or more.
Yeah. But it's like, why would you use a phrase like that to describe, which is essentially a pretty big deal, $1 billion company or a $2 billion company? It's like, you know, I look at that S-1 and I see there is a promise of growth. There is promise of opportunity. And, you know, I see again, a company built for a shifting economy. You know, are they perfect? Absolutely not. Were they valued perfectly? Not really. Who's to blame for that? Investors. Not the company, right? They will take the best valuation they can get at any given time. And when the media talks about valuation as your only yardstick of success, well, a lot of people start thinking that is the value, that is the yardstick of success, right? I mean, I wrote a post about this recently. You have to build value, not valuations. Valuations come as an outcome of value, not the other way around. And I think this is why I feel that the whole conversation around Square, IPO, or whatever is kind of, you know, upside down. I think we should be looking at, this is a pretty solid company targeting an audience which has been unserved for a very long time. And they're building the equivalent of AWS for financial services for small and medium businesses at scale. I think that's a pretty good, reasonable idea. What the market values it at, that is a different story. I think the company's value is spot on.
So yeah, I shouldn't have paid attention to the headlines that say, like this Issy Lipowski headline in Wired, Square's low IPO price could signal hard time for unicorns.
No, I think Om's right. I think actually Square is almost a better IPO investment than some other companies, in part because they pivoted relatively recently to purely focusing on SMBs. So I think a lot of their growth is actually in front of them, unlike some companies that have the growth is entirely private.
Yeah.
But two, I mean, the narrative around this Square IPO, I think, is in the pricing is totally backwards. This is strong evidence that there is absolutely not a bubble, because the whole idea of I wrote this 6 months ago and saying it's not like 1999. Like, a big part of a bubble is euphoria and the presumption there's always, you know, a bigger fool down the road, and that prices are going up for price's sake. I mean, if there was a bubble, we should expect that this valuation to be even higher and there to be wild speculation about it. And there's not. People are being quite rational about it. And you can argue that within a narrow band of financing, the growth level, that there are some evaluations that are perhaps unwarranted. But that's very different than the sort of prevailing narrative that there's structural issues that are going to go up in smoke. And I agree. Like, there is a business here. I think it's probably being evaluated correctly. And oh, by the way, Om talks about value versus valuation. You look at the terms, and like, the fact the valuation was always a myth, and it wasn't a myth just because all valuations are myth. They are, but it was a myth because the people buying in at that $6 billion valuation were not really paying $6 billion. They included lots of caveats that, like, if it's priced, the IPO is priced lower, we get a bigger share of stock that guarantees returns. There's all these sorts of things in the agreements that if you were to actually price the value of that optionality, the reality would be that the valuation is probably about where it ended up being. And the top, and this is a reminder, I think, for people paying attention to this, that whatever's reported as a valuation, if you don't understand the underlying terms that go into that valuation, it is not just a meaningless number, it's an actively disingenuous number. And that's the case almost certainly for nearly every single unicorn, that the number is in a proper accounting, is not what it is. And frankly, I mean, I don't know, the whole narrative, the whole bubble narrative in general is very frustrating to me. I think there is issues. There are things going on, but it's nothing like 1999. And anyone that even suggests that it is, I'm going to pull the Om's line. I think you're a little young. I mean, it was, you can't compare to what was going on back then.
Except for real estate. I think the real estate is pretty 1999 right now. And salaries too. So things are a little insane from the salary standpoint and also from real estate standpoint.
Right, exactly. I think that's exactly right. There is something going on, but it's totally different than what was happening then. And my bigger concern, and I think this is, I'm potentially planning to write about this week. My bigger concern is this is a different kind of, I don't want to use the word bubble. It's a different kind of economic problem where the other problem with a lot of these companies raising huge amounts of money is they can be in business for a long time without having a viable model. It's almost zombie companies in a way. And that has its own problems, and they're significant problems. They're more about opportunity cost and things like that, and the sort of companies that aren't being built and aren't scaling the way they ought to because talent is so dispersed, because real estate costs are out of control. And those are very real issues, but they're almost 180-degree different issues from an underlying perspective than what was happening in 1999.
Yeah, the one thing which people keep forgetting, whether it is Square or any other, you know, delivery service or any consumer product service online, any company which is being valued at whatever valuation, there is a factor of human friction. Like, people can only, you know, consume things so much. Remember Groupon? That wasn't a bad idea. It was an idea which ran into human friction. We couldn't really consume all those deals all the time, right? Like, we only have so much money we can spend on things. You know, there is so many times in a day you can order from Postmates or from Munchery or Sprig, right? Like, you can't order two lunches. I mean, you can, but you can only eat one lunch, right? Unless, like, you have other problems. But
sometimes, like, I have three or four.
Reminds me of the pay-to-play market for games.
So
first lunch is freemium. Standpoint,
yeah, I think we have this. You know, we as an industry always forget that there is a human friction. There is people in the real world who have to pay for these services and goods, and all that takes a little bit longer than what you project on a spreadsheet. I think people just, you know, I mean, if let's say if Uber went away today, there's a lot of people who would be unhappy, like, guaranteed, right? That's a valuable long-term company which is being built, in my opinion. Like, there is a lot of value there because the universe would miss it. Like, same is with, you know, I mean, if Postmates went away, I would be kind of upset. Like, you know.
What does Postmates do? I don't even know.
It just gets me food. That's what it does. Oh.
It gets you anything you want whenever you want it. That's what
it does. It's a lunch, a logistics company.
Anything like is like a myth, but it's food is pretty good.
See, only people who live in cities know about that because, of course, they don't deliver here.
It's Petaluma.
It's not in Petaluma?
No, I don't think so. I think Petaluma is too small.
Surprise.
Aren't you like, isn't that like the farmland and everything?
Yeah, we don't need
Charlie
to.
Brown.
You grow your own food.
We don't.
Right?
We actually grow and cook our own food. Did you? Yeah. I'm sure you did. In fact, it feels like you're referring to it a little bit. The Atlantic article by Robin Sloan. Why I quit ordering from Sprig, and specifically from Uber for food startups. And she talks about. It's an interesting article. Is it? I hope she's a she. I maybe made an incorrect assumption, but she talks about the contrast. Something called Josephine, which is a neighborhood thing where you order food from somebody in your neighborhood who just have to cook some extra, and you go over to their house and you take it and you eat it and you have to plan ahead. And Sprig, where she says it's all about, you know, I want this food now. And she says, I feel like, you know, there's a whole underclass of people here that I'm seeing that I feel bad. She actually feel bad for. She likes Josephine because it's somebody who's cooking and you kind of have this experience with them. Versus the stranger who's delivering you with a Sprig. Did you read this, Om?
I did.
What'd you think?
You know, interesting
as a Sprig
article.
User.
I don't use Sprig. I use Munchery.
Okay. Similar?
Sprig's quality is pretty dicey.
Ah.
All over the map.
She mentions that. She had a bad chicken sandwich from Sprig. Which may be the real reason she quit ordering from them.
I think Om's point is a really good one. This concept of because the costs of getting started are so much lower than they used to be, that there's way more companies than there are today.
Right.
But the ability of the market to digest companies and to, I mean, develop new habits around these sorts of things is fundamentally limited. And that means that we should expect there to be more attrition than ever before, just because there's more people, there's more companies being born, but you know, not that many more. And we shouldn't expect there to be that many more, you know, coming out the other side. And that's okay. That's normal. That's a good thing. It's great that it's easier to get companies started than ever before. You know, primarily thanks to AWS and similar types of services. I worry about the opportunity cost of all, especially engineering in particular, being spread out more thinly than ever before. But yeah, the human capacity point is a really powerful one.
What's you know, all? I think when you were talking about that article in the Atlantic, right?
Yeah.
When I read that article, my thinking was, well, when this we had the Industrial Revolution, and in the 21st century, the idea of food and how people consume food changed, and fast food chains came around, right? Now we are once again changing the idea of time, work, you know, live. All those things are being redefined because we are infinitely more connected all the time. So the restaurants will have to look somewhat different. Like, so to me, Sprig looks like a fast food chain, not a restaurant, right? Like, except it doesn't have a physical space where you go and get the food. The food comes to you. So is it the same? I think the old underclass is being replaced by the new underclass, if that's what she's talking about, except, you know, it's the reality of how the world is changing, right? I'm not saying she's right or wrong, but I do feel that we have to recognize the fact as a society we are changing because of how the on-demand behavior has become pervasive, at least in urban areas. And now if you look at cities like Shanghai or even San Francisco, there is much less retail space being built, right? So if you want to open a restaurant, you have to pay a premium on rent, which means the food is priced at a premium. So only a certain kind of people can go to the restaurant. So there is like a demographic, you know, barrier being created around what is the food experience. I think a lot of it, we just look at it from a very narrow perspective without trying to understand how the society is changing. I think how the iPhone and the smartphone itself has changed the society's behaviors is like spread out. It's like on food, it's on how we communicate, it's on how we find, you know, relationships. Everything is being redefined because we have a much more real-time, you know, existence now because of the phone in our pocket. I think it is easy to dismiss, you know, that I don't like this, but well, this may be the model of the future. Not that I would like to eat from Sprig because their food does suck, but.
I like Sprig.
I can't get Sprig. So
there's something to the real.
I can't get Postmates either. I checked. They're not in the Petaluma.
There is something profound about thinking about evaluating the impact of a product based on sort of its knock-on effects on other parts. I mean, Am just mentioned rents. I think one of the most fascinating things about AWS is there's been this shift in startup land from the valley up to the city. And there's lots of reasons for that shift to consumer, you know, different preferences. But part of it is you don't need to have server space in your office. You can start a company in a WeWork office and then bump up to, you know, a 1,000-foot square space or whatever and grow from there. Whereas before you had to start out with space and not to mention the whole cost of servers and Oracle databases and all that sort of stuff. Like there's very real. I met someone, a structure reader who works in construction. I've told this story a couple of times, so sorry if I'm repeating myself for people who listen. But he works in construction and he works in retrofitting old offices. And the biggest part of all their jobs is retrofitting old server space. Like there's all this infrastructure, all this air conditioning, all this sort of stuff, yeah. And it's because of AWS. And that gets at in a sort of very profound way the impact of AWS. Same thing that Am said with the smartphone. And frankly, that's why, as Am noted, I think that's why Uber is such a big deal. It's not just because it's replacing the taxi industry. It's the potential to replace the car broadly. And you replace the car, so you need less parking spaces. You need less parking spaces, you can build different kind of buildings. You build different kind of buildings, you get different sort of foot traffic. You might get people living closer. You might get different density, different real estate patterns. Like that is, you want to talk about changing the world. Like that is how the world is actually changed by some of these products. And yeah, not that many make the cut, but the ones that do, I mean, the impact really can't be overstated.
We're going to take a break. Amazon has opened up a brick-and-mortar store in the weirdest story of the week. We'll talk about that and a lot more. Malik is here from ohm.co, his blog. Do you have money invested in Twitter? I suppose I should ask.
No.
No. I'm sorry.
I have no public market stocks. I've never owned any.
Really?
And yep. And I don't intend to.
You figure by the time they go public, it's a bad deal.
Pretty much.
Get in early. Sell it when they go public.
Mm-hmm. That's why I'm in the venture business, man.
Yeah, and it's an adventure.
It's a definitely.
That was a terrible joke.
That's a pretty good one.
I like it. Bad joke.
Bad jokes are us. That's Stephen Kovach, TechInsider.io. Ben Thompson's also here from Stratechery. We're talking about mobile. I got to talk about mobile payments and the best way to set up mobile payments for your app or website, for that matter, Braintree. Braintree is code for easy mobile payments. 10 lines of code on almost any platform. And all of a sudden, your customers, your users, get access to all the payment systems they want. Apple Pay, Android Pay, PayPal, Venmo, credit cards, even Bitcoin. And you know, when something else comes along, Braintree supports that too. The example of what happened when Android Pay came out last month is amazing. You know, if you were a Braintree user, you open your control panel, boom, you check the box, now you've got Android Pay. That easy. And the best, really, recommendation for Braintree is their customers. Of course, GitHub uses Braintree, which means you probably use Braintree too. You ever take an Uber ride or a Lyft ride? That's Braintree. Airbnb, hotels tonight, that's Braintree. Braintree is everywhere. Those new buyable pins from Pinterest, Braintree. And that's the beauty. Braintree makes it easy to make payments for your customers, eliminating the problem of abandoned carts, getting you more sales with Braintree's best-in-class mobile checkout experience. In some cases, there's no checkout at all. The V.0 SDK, that's Uber. Then you just get out of the car. That's the checkout. Braintree's amazing. I want you to try it. You can get a little sandbox experience if you go to braintreepayments.com/twit. Check out the integration. It's easy across all platforms, superior fraud protection, customer service, very fast payouts to you, and your first $50,000 in transactions are fee-free. Braintreepayments.com/twit. If you've been looking for the right solution, your search is over. Braintreepayments.com/twit. Loved the review in the New Republic of the new brick-and-mortar store. It's in Seattle, I think. For Amazon.com. The review was by, you know, obviously somebody who loves small independent bookstores. And he was just mocking. The word he used was the banality of Amazon's bookstore. Why does Amazon... By the way, I'm glad you're here, Ohm, because it was, I think, at least 2, maybe 3 years ago that you said the next step for Amazon was to open a store. You said that. Oh, he's muted. Are you there? There we go.
Do you want to say something to me?
Congratulations. You are right. So
it starts with an S, ends with a Y.
Starts with an S. This is like a tough crossword puzzle and ends with a Y. How many letters?
Sorry, I believe.
Sorry? Did we mock you at the time?
Oh, yeah. You and Scobo and... Yeah.
We said, why? Why would you open a store? Well, is this the store that you were hoping that they would open?
It's not bad. I think the review made it sound like it was terrible.
Yeah.
Dustin was hard to get past the snark.
There was a lot of snark.
It was a snarky piece. I mean, I didn't take it too seriously.
Consider the source, too, the New Republic. I mean, these are people who want to preserve independent bookstores and loathe Amazon.
Yeah, I went there last week just to check it out.
Oh, did you? What'd you think? What's your review?
My review is... On a scale of 1 to 10, I would give them 6.
Okay.
I mean, it's not like, but it was clear why they set it up. It's all to essentially showcase their products, not just the books.
It's a Kindle showroom, in effect.
It's just an Amazon showroom. Yeah. And that it makes it more attractive to people because it's a bookstore.
Yeah.
Right? Most people want to walk into a bookstore versus...
It's cozy.
You know... Walking into not many people walk into the Kindle store or the Microsoft stores, which are in the mall, but the books is something people want to kind of get a closer look at. So it's kind of, interesting, ironic, whichever way you want to see it. It's not an Apple store, like, just to be clear.
No.
Like, it's not setting, like, any design standards or anything.
But as I remember, what the reason you thought Amazon should open a store was really that the future of retail...
Don't cry, Leo. You can say sorry.
I'm sorry, the future of retail was online, and that the experience of gathering with others and, you know, having a coffee, that it was all about experiential stuff. That's what a brick and mortar store should be.
Yeah.
This doesn't sound like that.
No. But they, you know, they will tweak and get it right, in my opinion. I think it's not a terrible store. Let's just be clear.
It's probably a money-losing store, though, for Amazon, right? It's not a... Judging from this article, the rents... they're in an old sushi restaurant. But the Barnes & Noble that used to be there was kind of run out by high rents. It'd be difficult, this fella thinks, as does the manager of the university bookstore up the hill, that it would be difficult for them to make money
in the store. If I can get two gripes in, I mean, one... to make categorical statements about anything is problematic. Like all right. retail will be you know, e-commerce. That obviously won't be the case. And two,
why would you buy a book in a bookstore?
Well, two, this insistence on judging the financial viability or long-term success of any sort of new initiative based on a version one, what is clearly an experiment, is a waste of time and space. I mean, of course, it better be losing money. If they're making profit on it from day one, and it's like, why don't they have the entire food
Everywhere.
Stores open now?
But
the other thing too is, as long as it's as good as a standard bookstore, which even this guy had to admit it was, well, given the back end infrastructure Amazon brings to bear, it actually might be profitable. I mean, the reality is you can innovate in a business model without changing the consumer facing part of the product at all. And you can build a bog standard bookstore that has a superior back end and be far more profitable.
Right.
But sorry, that's my rant aside. I actually want to hear the rest of Om's impressions.
No, you make excellent points, Ben, and I stand corrected. Go ahead, Om.
Well, I didn't buy anything from there, if that's what you
were. But were you tempted to buy the new Paperwhite or anything?
Well, that's the thing. Well,
no.
Sorry, you got to look at it systematically, right? It's building Amazon customers. There was a story.
What? How? I don't understand how this builds Amazon customers. This isn't even Amazon's business. Their business is not having you go into a store and look at books and buying them. Their business is you decide you want to buy a book, you go online, you press a button.
So they should probably cancel AWS because it doesn't fit their business.
Well, no. Okay, that's obviously not the case. AWS is maybe their best business.
But that's the thing. You have to look at it systematically. I think that's why it makes Amazon a harder company to appreciate than other companies where it's all, you know, Apple, it's all out there.
Buy Ohm's contention this is really about a showroom for Amazon physical products like the Kindle and the Fire?
I think it's about getting you into the Amazon ecosystem. We already know a Prime customer spends about $1,600 a year versus a normal customer spends about $400.
Right.
Like the value of being a part of it, and this is just another entry point. And again, it's version one, it's experiment. I'm sure they're trying to figure it out, and it might fail. The great thing about Amazon is they do lots of stuff that fails and they close it down. They closed down another business this past week. I can't remember which one it was. And so maybe they'll close it, and that's fine, and they're cool with that. And if it succeeds, well, that's I saw another story. I'm trying to find where it is, but they talked about it was kind of a mocking story too, and they mentioned in the story about someone walked out with a Prime membership.
Oh,
like I'm pretty sure from Amazon's perspective, that's a pretty
that's
successful
a win.
Transaction.
The big one.
Ohm, how was the Wi-Fi in there? Was it good?
No, I don't know. I didn't try it. I use LTE wherever I go.
Yeah,
I think Wi-Fi is
it disappoints.
Kind of no. So I think the way to think about these stores is, let's say they have a book reading. You know,
right.
Book reading is part of the book ecosystem.
No, and that's what you said two years ago. Right. Exactly.
Right. They need. So if all the bookstores go away, there's very few left. Where do all the authors go for doing the book readings and having one-on-one interaction with their fans?
You almost don't even need books in this bookstore, frankly.
Right. Like, and I bet you most of the books were stock to move, not stock to stay there.
Right.
Like, because they have much more intelligence about what sells in what part of Seattle, right? So they're going to stock books which are kind of, you know, in of interest to people in that region. However, like when you look at this, like it was interesting that I would go in, there's a book author, you know, I listen to the author, buy the book, probably order it or do something. And I also check out the new Kindle or the new Kindle Fire or the new Fire TV. And who knows, I might end up with one more product. Like I walk out with one more product or Prime membership or something. And I think that ties you into the ecosystem more tightly, more ecosystem, perhaps not the right word, the Amazon experience. You're, you know, experiencing Amazon at a much more real physical level. So it actually means you can go and trust them. And when you buy stuff from them online, which is what probably they are going for. I mean, you know, why would Microsoft open a Microsoft store? They don't need to, but they have, because it's all about
It's different selling computers. I think Apple and Microsoft both realize that the experience of buying computers in a computer store does not benefit them. You know, you go to, I don't even know, at a Best Buy, I guess, is the last place you could still go. And you're not, that's not going to be a good buying experience for anybody.
So where are you experiencing Kindle Fire? Where
well, you can't. That's right. That's right.
Exactly. Yeah. So,
although we know now from Pew that only 18% of adults have ebook readers anymore anyway.
That may only.
That may be a dying business. That's down quite a bit.
Well,
although I just bought the new Paperwhite and I looked at it and I feel like I'm in the 50s. So
I'm saying something super duper important, though, that gets at why the vast majority of talk about this has been kind of facile. It's that Amazon evaluates, Amazon is thinking according to long-term value of a customer. Like, it's almost like a CPG company. Like, why do you see ads for deodorant or for dishwasher soap? It's because once you get in a habit of buying something, you're going to buy it for the rest of your life. And actually that small purchase magnified by buying it every month for the rest of your life is tremendously valuable. That's why you have, you know, P&G falling over themselves to get on different platforms where they can reach young people. It's the same sort of thing with Amazon. Just getting a new customer, and particularly getting a new Prime customer, pays off over decades.
Yeah.
And so you can't properly evaluate this store or any other initiative Amazon does unless you have visibility into what the lifetime value of a customer is, what the churn rate is, all these sorts of things that go into calculating that. And frankly, anecdotally speaking anyway, I live in Taiwan. I don't even have access to Amazon. I still have an Amazon Prime membership because that's how phenomenal the experience is for when I'm just back or whatever. And I think lots of people who are Prime members are know that's the case. And the way you stop thinking, you just buy stuff when you need it. And man, I the value, if this gets people, if it gets like that guy buying a Prime membership or gets them buying a device and getting locked into this and the whole Amazon video thing tied to Prime and all this sorts of things. I mean, again, I wouldn't be surprised if this store's, I would bet it's losing money today. I wouldn't be surprised if it loses money forever if you only look at the store. But to only look at the store is to not understand Amazon as a company.
I think the analogy is when you get a credit card from American Express in college. It's not about the college, you know, credit card. It's more like how long are you going to be an American Express customer, perhaps for most of your life.
Since 1980.
And that's where the long-term value for Amazon is. And I think that's how they're, like, now they have to get a lot more people into the Amazon ecosystem.
Did Google make a mistake then, deciding not to go ahead with its New York City store? They renovated it for $6 million, and now they're pulled out.
Well, it's a different business. I mean, Amazon...
Google has nothing to sell.
Consumer business is about that lifetime value of selling you things. Google's is not.
Okay. Not everybody needs a retail store. So I shouldn't open a Twit retail store in downtown San Francisco, probably.
Probably not.
I do like, though, what Ohm's vision for this store was, which was really a place to congregate, to hear authors speak, not so much to buy books, but it is still the same idea, which is a goodwill venture for Amazon. And maybe there's a little sign up as you go out the door for Prime.
It's great that it goes to the core of what Amazon started as, which is a virtual online bookstore. Yeah. And, you know, they didn't build a Walmart clone that, you know, right. You don't go there and buy toilet paper, which you can do on Amazon.com. They went there and, you know, it's a nice bookstore. And that kind of builds that familiarity with the brand again. And again, it's I totally agree with what Ben is saying. It's just locking you any way they can to lock you in, whether you walk in with and walk out with a Kindle, or walk in and walk out with a Prime membership, or just like a good feeling about Amazon. It's a win for them.
How much of Amazon's business is feeling. Still books, I wonder?
What it's not, it's shrinking. The portion of media, which is books and software and packaged music and stuff like that, is I think 19% and falling.
Wow.
Although it's still very profitable. But I think what's interesting is they did start with books the first time, and they're starting with books now. But I think the reasons are actually very different. When they started with books the first time is because books had a huge amount of margin to play with, frankly. And they had, and it fit the whole Amazon vision. You could offer every book in the world. When a regular bookstore couldn't. And books were just a perfect fit for getting a company like Amazon off the ground. And I think Bezos has said he wouldn't have any particular attraction to books per se, just it was the perfect thing to start with. Whereas here, I think what Om said is a really great point. Like, no one wants to walk into an Amazon store. I mean, yeah, we all care about Amazon because we're geeks and we're, you know, some tiny minority who uses Twitter. But the people like going into bookstores. They like browsing. They like looking around. And that makes, if you're going to enter retail, to Steve's point, to deliver an experience that builds affinity for your company and your brand and leads to other products and all that sorts of things, books are a pretty compelling place to start. And it's just a happy coincidence that it really fits the Amazon branding and origin story as it is.
Let's talk about Comcast in a moment. Data caps are coming, and Comcast, I love this leaked memo, whether it's real or not. It's telling the customer sales reps how to position this. It's not about the data caps. It's not about congestion. It's about giving you a better experience. But first, a word from FreshBooks. If you're a freelancer, you know the key to making a living is billing. You can do the work, but if you forget to invoice, you're not going to get paid. So if you are a freelancer, can I make a suggestion? Make it easy on yourself to do the most important part of your business. Send out those invoices with FreshBooks. It's the super simple cloud accounting software that's giving thousands, more like millions of freelancers like you, the tools to save time billing and get paid faster. You'll be creating and sending invoices in minutes, even if you're not a numbers person, especially if you're not. If you're a creative, you're going to love this. Get paid up front. You can actually request a deposit in FreshBooks. No more covering costs out of pocket or waiting until the end of a project to get paid. Isn't that a cool idea? Hey, there's going to be some expenses associated with this. Would you like to put in a deposit ahead of time? You can organize your expenses easily. The FreshBooks app lets you take pictures of receipts and get them right into the invoice. Of course, you can track time and hours on that FreshBooks app almost instantly. Again, goes right into the invoice. And with FreshBooks automated customer reviews report, you can see all your reviews in one place, then easily post them on your website. They're really expanding the offerings they give the freelancer to make it a better experience for everybody. You'll wonder why you didn't start sooner. If you've got questions, of course, the FreshBooks support rock stars are there. Help is free forever. They'll go above and beyond whenever you need a hand. And I'll tell you, I started using this in 2004. I'm no longer a freelancer, but I have to say it was such a lifesaver. It was the only way I got paid. You got to send out those invoices. You can't put them off. FreshBooks.com/twit. You could try it free for 30 days. Do me a favor. Mention This Week in Tech when they ask, how did you hear about us? Your 30-day free trial awaits. All the fun stuff. You get to do all the fun stuff of your business and let FreshBooks handle the paperwork. This Week in Tech. That's all you have to say when they said, how'd you hear about us? FreshBooks.com/twit. 30 days free. This Comcast memo went out on Reddit, which of course makes it instantly suspect. Although when you read it, it sounds pretty realistic. Comcast has started to expand its trial of data caps. They were doing 250. Hey, don't worry. It's 300 gigabytes a month now. And apparently this memo that was leaked was to customer service representatives telling them how to discuss these new data caps. For instance, do say fairness and providing a more flexible policy to our customers. Don't say the program is about congestion management. It's not. Under the new plans, and you may or may not be subject to this, one of the things Comcast says is, well, everybody has a 250 gigabyte data cap. We just don't enforce it everywhere. Implying that they plan to do this everywhere. The number one ISP in the country. Under the new plans, customers can opt to pay an extra $30 to $35 a month to unlock unlimited internet access. But if you don't, you'll be charged $10 for each additional 50 gigabytes. And they max out, by the way, at 600. Then you're on the extreme tier. And after that, all bets are off. What do you think?
I'd be so hosed.
I know.
No way.
You know, most people say 300 gigabytes. I'm not going to hit that.
That's with all the video I stream on my big screen TV, yeah, I'd be done in half.
You know, 6 hours of Netflix and you're gonna a day, you're going to do it.
You know, I mean, move from my building because I
you
have
can't move. Yeah.
No. I don't move because I have a web pass, which is not Comcast.
Right. You have it's kind of a community internet, from the building.
No, it's not community internet. It's a commercial ISP.
All right.
They are independent ISP.
It's urban internet.
Urban internet. I'm getting close to 300 megabits per second right now.
Oh my God. That's amazing. Yeah, nice.
I mean, this is exactly what we should have expected to happen once net neutrality was banned.
Wait a minute. I thought we had net neutrality.
Enforced. Sorry, I used the wrong word. This is entirely 100% predictable. I fortunately wrote it at the time when the net neutrality debate was going down. I mean, and if you back up and look at it from a, if you want to incentivize faster and faster broadband speeds, well, this is a great way to do it. Comcast now has a great incentive to get you even faster internet, because the faster internet you have, the more you'll download and the more they can earn. So setting aside the other issues, like from a certain perspective, this is a good development, because now they have good incentives to improve internet. And once you removed the opportunity for them to charge for discriminatory data, then it was inevitable that this was going to happen, for one. That said, there's certainly lots of issues here. For one, Comcast does violate net neutrality blatantly, as does every other provider, because Comcast's own data does not count against the cap.
They have apps, for instance, like the Xfinity app for Xbox, which does not get counted.
Right. And just cable television uses a tremendous amount of data. They're going over the same wires. It uses a tremendous amount of data, and that doesn't count either. So that there's certainly problems there. But the reality is as long as you're not going to have a regulated environment, which again has its own problems, it's not a panacea by any means, and its own problems, particularly around incentives, that this was inevitable. And frankly, I'm a little tired of, in this entire debate, there's a lot of people want to have their cake and eat it too. Like they want private companies to do things that aren't, they want them to give, to infinitely invest in new capacity and not discriminate data and not charge for it. I mean, like, I'm sorry, like, if you want to have a debate, you should have a debate about whether this should be a regulated industry, whether the underlying infrastructure should be government provided, and then there'd be competition on top of it. The best markets in the world work that way, where the wires themselves are a public good, and then ISPs compete on top of that.
So is that how it works in Taipei? Is that your situation?
Yeah, I have like 10 select choices for internet access.
But it's all the same wires. They're government owned.
It's a privatized company, but yeah, the access is regulated. Right. So yeah, no, I have 100. I don't have 300 down. I have 100 down, and I'm paying $30 a month for it. Yeah. It's just like this is an inevitable sort of thing. And I think that maybe this will wake people up to being a little more serious about it. The problem in the U.S. obviously is the per our earlier discussion, the political system, particularly when it comes to anything government related or regulation or that sort of thing, is so extreme in a sort of anti-government sort of attitude that this is an inevitable outcome. And again, all things considered, I think it's a good thing actually, because I want there to be more and faster data. I'm concerned about the people who can't afford it, and that's something that we need to have more of a conversation about.
But don't you think it's also kind of not just the net neutrality thing, but a reaction to just the growing cord cutters? I mean, doesn't Comcast now have more internet-only subscribers than they do internet and TV?
Totally.
It's super smart because they protect themselves against that.
Totally, and they get the cap in now when most people aren't violating it, and by the time the people start violating it, well, it's part of the landscape. No, I mean, from a pure business perspective, it's a smart move by Comcast, and frankly, from a systematic perspective, I think you can make the case, given the realities of the U.S. political system, it's the best of bad alternatives. I'm glad we have net neutrality, but this is the trade-off that comes with net neutrality.
How about this? Hey, go ahead.
It's a little heavy. Things got heavy there for a minute. Yeah. I think there is another way to think about it, and this is what I've always argued for, is that if you can charge more money for higher tiers, so if you want a 100 megabit connection, Comcast should absolutely charge more money for it. And that's how they pay for their networks, by paying, by making more money off people who want the latest and the greatest speeds, right? Just like Intel would make the most money from people who wanted the latest and greatest Pentium chips or whatever, right? These days it's i7. So similarly, ISPs should be going after that very model, rather than saying, yes, we're going to go for that model, but we'll also limit how much bandwidth you can consume. And then we will charge, you know, companies like Facebook and Google and Netflix more money on top of that to bring the data, which you and I have actually paid for, to access, you know, to access that data. So they want to like eat their cake and you know, have it and eat it, and just it's insane. Like, I just think the whole thing, yeah, it just is like, you know, there is, and they save so much money when they offer in network bandwidth. They don't have to deal with, you know, their frequencies on their cable are much more efficiently utilized with much fewer overheads and much less cost to them. And so from that standpoint, I think, you know, they're not being fully honest about things like how much is their cost. They never talk about their cost. They never talk about what's the real economic model. It is all shrouded in ambiguous, you know, stuff, which is what this memo was all about. I think nobody's saying that, you know, that we shouldn't pay for higher speed tiers. I think absolutely, if my ISP said $200 or $500 for a 1 gigabit connection, yep, you can have it. You know, I want the 1 gigabit connection and I will pay for it. And so be it. Like, I think that's how they should be pricing, and not double dipping on the other side too. I think that's the problem I have with the cable companies and the phone company.
I think for the caps to make sense, it would have to be tied to increased costs on their end. It seems much more likely to me.
No, that's not how pricing works. Pricing works not based on your cost of inputs. It's based on what price the market will bear.
Well, and that's why the problem here. Using this as a heavy hammer to discourage cord cutters. I mean, the only people who are going to use more than 300 gigabytes are people who are using services that compete directly with Comcast's television business. Right?
The fundamental issue here is that Comcast effectively has a monopoly in most of the markets it competes
Absolutely.
In.
I mean, phone
service is not there.
That's what we need to get at. There we go.
So, I mean, I guess just broadly, I just have yes, you can say what they should do and they ought to do. I just don't have much room for their telling businesses what they should do, because like some blogger on the internet really wants them to do it. And I put myself in that category. The issue in the U.S. is the lack of competition. And usually you deal with lack of competition by regulation, But again, for various political reasons, that's not really the case in the U.S. So given that, we're in a bad situation. And so my argument is, given the crappy situation we find ourselves in, all things considered, this is a better outcome than favoring some sorts of data over others.
Well, but they're doing both.
No. I mean, the actual stuff coming over the internet is treated non-discriminatory.
That's not true.
It is true. The issue when it comes to coming in the back end is Netflix has always been able to go over the general internet stream. Is that for quality of service reasons, Netflix wants.
But Comcast does not charge against its data caps for its own apps.
Exactly, which I noted. Yeah. No, that's true. And I think that's why the regulations are still problematic, which also gets to the problem with regulations in general. You can never regulate perfectly, which I think is something people tend to forget. But no, let's not lose sight of the big picture. The big picture is a warped market. And so my statements about this being a relatively speaking good thing, we're in the context of a warped market.
It seems like, okay, so it's either they're the price gouging or they're anti-competitive. But
They're already anti-competitive.
Come on, there's got to be something better than that. That's what you're saying. Well, we got ourselves into this.
It's that the U.S. get its crap together when it comes to regulating monopolies.
But they're trying to, but the monopolies don't seem to want to cooperate.
We just had a political discussion. Like there's at least 50% of this country that finds any sort of government intervention in anything completely anathema and worth going to the battle parts over. That's the reality we exist in, and. Right. There's an aspect of making, you know.
So you're saying, given that environment, then you shouldn't be shocked if a corporate entity is rapacious and makes as much money as it can.
Given the environment, this is exactly what should have been expected.
Right.
And like I said, it's still better than.
And with a monopoly, you have no recourse. Yeah, it's probably a little better than it could have been, I guess.
Fiber comes to your town, then. Yeah. You know, the cable companies we've already seen that happen in Kansas.
A strong societal interest in not letting the internet service providers become these kinds of rapacious gatekeepers.
It would be wonderful if we made laws based on that idea.
Yeah.
I agree.
You're just a cynic.
I don't think he's being cynical at all.
He's being a realist. That's what cynics always say. Yeah. I'm not cynical. I'm a realist.
He is.
Ben, you must be excited. The iPad Pro is just a few days away. You won't have to draw your napkin graphs on a little mini iPad anymore.
Oh, that's a particularly bad drawing. I assume.
Another one.
I have better ones.
Let's see. Let's find some more. I'm a subscriber, so I can scroll through all of this content.
Are you ready for the Apple Pencil, Ben?
I am. I'm very excited about it.
Yeah, this is how he does those.
It goes both ways. I mean, I do all these on paper, and that's a really old one. Like especially, and I was really lazy that day, which is actually a few years ago. I reused it.
All right.
But there's paper is amazing, especially the latest one. It's these really cool updates. And I'm excited about the iPad Pro because of if you go down the Twitter article, there's a pretty good one, I think. The Moments one.
Okay.
Just scroll down the page.
Yeah.
I'm excited about it from a product perspective, but like everything related to the iPad, I'm like 53 is making an app for the iPad Pro, and I'm sure it's going to be awesome. And I have zero idea of how they're going to make money for it beyond the fact that they have VC money, and so they kind of have to push forward and try to figure something out.
Yeah, this
they
is
make
nice.
Money by selling. That's they make good. Money by selling a stylus.
Right.
And
a few extra colors and shapes and things, right?
No, that's all free.
It's all free now. Oh, it's all the stylus.
They make the money from the stylus. Their biggest source of income is the stylus sold in Apple stores. Is Apple going to pull their stylus?
Why would you buy it? Why wouldn't you just buy the pencil and be done with it?
Well, for now, the pencil only works with the iPad Pro, not the smaller ones.
So Apple still sell the other one.
Well, the big issue is that Apple continues to be a terrible ecosystem supporter. I mean, there's... The issue with the iPad, the use case for a phone and for a computer is pretty clear. It's not clear. What makes an iPad both intriguing and challenging from the beginning is it needs to generate new use cases that haven't come before. And per Om's point before, those just don't – I almost talk about a financial perspective, but also from just a general ability of people to absorb new capacity perspective, that's really, really hard to do. And Apple needs apps to do that, but apps are only going to be developed if there's a viable business model around building them, and there just isn't one. But we talked about this last time, so I'm repeating myself.
Let's take a break. We'll talk about OneDrive next. Prepare for OneDrive. Get in gear. First, though, a word from Squarespace, my blog host. It's a really a lot of fun. In fact, I've been blogging a lot more because I like the platform so much. Squarespace is beautiful. It's a state-of-the-art technology. And somebody was telling me, I think it was Jason Calacanis, who said, you know, you'd be nuts to go out and hire a designer and build the technology and get a web engineer and all that stuff nowadays, because Squarespace has all of these state-of-the-art templates. They do all the things you need to do. They're mobile responsive. They look great on any size screen. They offer you e-commerce on every site. It's a super reliable hosting, and I mean, you just can't bring it down. And it's $8 a month. So this is just, it's crazy to do anything else. And I finally listened to my friend Jason. I said, all right. And I couldn't be more happy. I was easily able to import all my content over. In fact, the great thing about Squarespace, you go to squarespace.com, click the Get Started button, and you could try it for 2 weeks without a credit card, absolutely free. You can even import some of your existing content. So you really have a chance to play with and get in that sense of what it would be like. They've got great apps on iOS and Android that make it easy to post. I wrote an entire blog post on my iPhone the other day. It was so much fun. It was so easy. You can post via email as well. They're now offering $100 in AdWords credit if you opt for the business or commerce plan. But I think the best place to do is start at squarespace.com. Click this Get Started button. Choose your template. I'm still playing with the templates. I like my template, and I customized it a lot. But the nice thing is your content is completely independent of your template. So you can change back and forth. Decide, you know, today I feel like, you know, a little different. If you're a restaurant, they have special templates for them, for bands, for photographers, really great for photographers. So anybody who wants to express their unique aesthetic and vision and do it in a way that they have state-of-the-art web technology, this is the best way to go. Squarespace.com. Use our promo code TWIT when you buy. Again, it's free to try. You don't need to give them a credit card. But when you buy, use TWIT as the promo code. You get 10% off. And show your support for the show. And it's a good reason to try it today. It's a good reason to subscribe for a longer period of time. You know, I forgot when I set it up, I forgot to use my offer code. Don't forget to use the offer code, TWIT. If you missed anything this week, you missed some great stuff. Let's take a look at what happened this week on TWIT.
Previously on TWIT.
We have a group of seventh graders in the studio today. This is a podcasting class.
Those are the kids that are going to stick the dagger in all of our backs.
They're coming for us.
iOS Today.
Is the new Apple TV an iOS device?
The audience said yes.
Yes.
By Megan and Apple TV.
So we're watching a clip from Seth. By the way, look how good that looks.
Yeah. Yeah.
What did she say?
Oh, love that guy.
Backed up.
All about Android.
Google's got a new app called Who's Down? Always know who's free to hang out so you never miss out on the fun.
Come on, millennials. Let's hang out with our Android phones.
Who's down?
Now we're going to need to have people go to school just to, like, give therapy on how to be okay with missing out on stuff.
This is
just getting really bad.
Know-how.
This is something that is available to anybody who has a Google account.
Uh-huh.
And this shows you the bits of data that Google has been storing on you. So these are some of the voice searches that I've done.
We have gained the trust of Brian Burnett, and tomorrow we shall strike.
Wait, what?
Twit. I don't know. Say hello to the NSA. They're listening.
I probably should have scrubbed this before, but hello.
I love that know-how show. And coming up, a great week ahead. Let's see what Mike Elgin's planning.
Coming up this week, Apple's giant iPad Pro tablet and the optional Apple Pencil ship on Wednesday, November 11th. Microsoft releases Windows 10 Mobile on Thursday, November 12th. Also on Thursday, Microsoft rolls out its new Xbox One Experience update, which redesigns the dashboard and provides backward compatibility with more than 100 major Xbox 360 games. For all this and the rest of the news this week, subscribe to Tech News Today at twit.tv/TNT. Back to you, Leo Laporte.
Thank you, Mr. Mike Elgin. TNT, Monday through Friday, 10 a.m. Pacific, 1 p.m. Eastern Time 1800 UTC. I know Microsoft's rolling out a big Xbox update because I got my new Beatles OnePlus Blu-ray DVDs, remixed Beatles music in 5.1 surround, and I'm ready to play it. And my Xbox One is my DVD player, and it said, no, sorry, you can't do that till you download 3.8 gigabytes of update data. We are talking with Steve Kovach from TechInsider.io. Great to have you, Steve. Ohm Malik from Ohm.co. And, of course, Ben Thompson of Stratechery. You should subscribe. Is that going well for you, Ben?
That's going very well.
You're making a living?
You should just read. I mean, there's one free article a week. So, if you want more every day.
I subscribed.
Daily update.
I subscribed. You get just really great, insightful stuff. What about, by the way, I know you read about this on Tuesday. Activision Blizzard buying the makers of Candy Crush for, what is it, $5.9 billion? Are they nuts?
I don't know. They're the biggest video game company in the world, right?
Yeah, like, but they don't have a sequel.
It's kind of weird that they're, just kind of hoping that another Candy Crush is in the works and they'll have another big cash cow, but...
Remember,
in a way, it's kind of them rounding out their portfolio. But yeah, I mean, these companies, there's Zynga, there's Rovio.
Yeah, remember Draw Something? OMG
Draw
Pop?
Something.
How much did they pay for that? Zynga. Just shows you, 2 years ago, they paid $200 million for it, right? Yeah. Or 4 years
ago.
No,
it's like $200. Was it?
Yeah, it wasn't that much. It seems like it was a lot at the time, doesn't it?
Look, I've written for a long time that investing in mobile games is very difficult because of this problem. But that said, to be fair, Candy Crush Saga is like 30-some percent of King's Digital, which is a lot, but it they're not just Candy Crush.
And what else is there?
Well, there's Candy Crush Soda, for one, which is also in the
It's in the Candy Crush sphere. All right. Yeah, yeah.
Well, and they have like 20, 30-some odd games ranging from top 50 to top 500.
If you include Soda and Crush... together is, I mean, it's only 30%. That's interesting. Must be more than that.
I think those two together is probably more than 50%.
Yeah.
I have to go back and look at the exact numbers. The general precept that these are difficult.
The problem is you tend to buy on the, at the absolute peak. You buy when the thing is making the most possible money.
Still making money.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah.
Well, also,
look at the App Store rankings now. Yeah, top grossing. Candy Crush number 4. Candy Crush Soda.
But how long is it going to last? And can they come?
While.
I mean, you look at Rovio. I mean, look. Nothing was stronger than Angry Birds, and they've done every possible derivative of it. But it's hard to find another hit.
Because they got busy making. They want to make movies. And Toyland and stuff like that.
That was a mistake. They should have focused on games.
Totally distracted from...
Yeah.
And there was some other dysfunctional stuff with the company, which will probably never get reported around Rovio. I think Candy Crush is one of the few games or companies with 100 million plus monthly active users.
330 million average monthly active... monthly unique users.
Right. That just is massive. Like, I think we don't quite understand, like, how powerful that is. I think there's very few companies of that scale right now. I mean, this company, I remember writing about King way back when, and I can't believe, like, how big they have become since then. I didn't really think of them as, like, a company which would be this massive, right, when they started out. They were doing... some kind of PC game or some kind of mobile games, but they were not really the guys positioned to be a $6 billion exit.
It feels like a successful mobile game is much like a viral video. It's lightning strikes. And it's clear now that companies like BuzzFeed have figured out how to make viral videos. Has King figured out how to make viral mobile games?
Well, I think the problem is... you're thinking about the business model wrong, because that's true for something like Angry Birds, where it's a paid upfront purchase.
But this is an annuity. This is money every month.
Right, exactly. So it's a very different type of business from that perspective. And yes, it is declining. It is slowly declining. And that's very different than something that has a huge upfront hit and then declines drastically. And I think the price does seem a little crazy to me, but I do think there is logic to this on both sides. From a from a king perspective, the hardest thing, there's a reason why Candy Crush Soda Saga is their number two hit, because the hardest thing is discovery. It's getting people even aware and trying your new product. And you bring a company like Activision with you know, Call of Duty and World of Warcraft and all the, and Guitar Hero and all these sort of titles that they have, and they help you get over that discovery and awareness hurdle to a much more powerful extent than almost anything else, particularly among a particular audience. And that's why you saw in the quotes coming out of this, the King CEO was practically giddy at like, oh, this.
Well, I'd have been giddy too. Yeah.
Well, no, but particularly around the IP angle.
Right.
On the flip side, though, from an Activision standpoint, they've launched lots of games. Most of them have been relative duds, and they've all mostly been paid up front. They've been experimenting a little with pay to play lately. But the problem is, it's just a very fundamental different business model and different skill set to create games that monetize well on
mobile.
What's
the secret of Candy Crush? Because it's really just Bejeweled, which was a big hit many years ago. So they didn't even invent a new gameplay or a new game at all.
Well, I'm not a freaking player. I've tried it, so I'm not any expert on this.
But it's addictive, that's for sure.
Well, there's two aspects to it. One is it has to be a good game. Like, at the end of the day, it has to be something that people find compelling going back to. And then two, the way in which you earn money has to be a way that at least some segment of the users doesn't find a turnoff and a push away, which Angry Birds, all the follow-ups are just all terribly done. And frankly, Activision's games, again, I haven't played them, but you see this from a lot of traditional game publishers. The pay-to-play aspect is like hitting you over the head with a hammer, and it's a big turnoff, right?
Right.
And I think there is absolutely a skill that comes with making people feel good about buying stuff. Buying things is not necessarily a bad experience. Amazon's so great at it. You buy stuff and you feel great about it, right?
Yeah, but buying virtual goods, it's hard to feel great about buying virtual goods.
All
come on. As somebody who spent $300 in donuts.
all evidence to the billions of dollars suggests that for some segment of people, it actually does feel pretty good. And that's the marriage here, is on one hand, you have the IP and the ability to break through all the noise to get a title off the ground. And on the other hand, you have the skill set to actually make a compelling game from that, and a compelling game that makes money in a way that users don't get turned off by. And it's those two together, not to use the dreaded corporate word synergy, but I think there is a synergy here where they're both bringing two very different skills to the table, and potentially to the benefit of both of them.
I hear music.
Never mind. Nothing. Just going to play a little Candy Crush Soda. Find the bears.
So I don't even know what I'm looking at.
I know. That's the funny thing. To me, it's like, huh? And obviously to most people, I don't know. It doesn't match three. Oh, see, they gave me rules now. Match three candies with the same color in a row. Okay.
The other thing to remember, Leo, is your experience right now is the exact opposite of the typical Candy Crush experience.
Why is that?
And because you're playing it with intent. Like, you're like, I'm going to go play Candy Crush and figure out what it is.
It's really kind of brainless, isn't it?
Well, it's
these I'm sort thinking of games, too much.
but that's the case. That's the case with all of Activision's games. You don't accidentally play Call of Duty. Right. You sit down and you install 3.1 gigabytes of updates, and then you put a headset on. You sit there for 3 hours and play it. And all of Activision's skills and their business model and everything is geared around an intentional activity. Mobile gaming is very different. It's stuff you do on the bus. It's stuff you do standing in line.
Right.
The sort of perspective of the person playing is very different, and it takes a very different skill set. And I think it's that skill set.
I think that might
along
be
along with the nice annuity that Activision's acquiring.
Is it a skill set? Oh, to make the games, not to play them, for sure. Oh, look, I got a gummy bear.
Got a bear.
I think the candy has something to do with it as well. All right. Yeah, it's a casual game is a very different kind of game. Doesn't Activision have anything in that category? I guess not. They have the Blizzard has the great card game.
Yeah, they have won the card game. I can't remember what the name is.
Yeah, Hearthstone.
Yes. But relatively speaking, that's like a top 30 game. It's not even the same. It's not
interesting.
You know who
loves Hearthstone? Gamers. It's really more of a gaming game than a mobile success. Well, yeah, I find this revolting. I just... And Ohm, you can't even look at this. Your doctor won't even let you look at this game. I don't think it's approved for your...
I'm just looking at how old you are.
Is it an age thing? I mean, I think of this as being played by a lot of middle-aged housewives more than anything. But am I wrong?
My mom plays it. I mean, my mom's almost 60, and she's addicted to the pet one. I forget what it's called, Pet Saga or something. That's all she does. She sits on her iPad while watching TV. And
wow.
Yeah.
Microsoft backed down on their unlimited OneDrive offer because people started using unlimited amounts of space. And they said, you know, we're not going to do that anymore. How damaging is this to Microsoft? Is it bad or is it not make any difference at all? Silence, dead silence. Nobody cares. Nobody cares at all.
I'm not
about
a big
this.
OneDrive user, so I don't even know. But I mean, I guess it kind of, are they grandfathering people in who?
No.
So you're just totally.
You're screwed. I mean, they won't delete your data for a while, but
This was a screw up. Like, it was a stupid thing to offer. And they're taking their medicine. And if anything, I think there's potentially an argument. Again, I'd like to get more specific details around the organizational structure behind OneDrive. But remember Microsoft's whole like functionally organizing thing. We're going to have marketing over here and we're going to have product over here.
Completely reorganized.
This sounds like a fundamental communication breakdown. Like marketing, it sounds great from a marketing perspective. Someone from finance or engineering should have actually run the numbers.
Right.
Because this is the internet. There's going to be bad actors that are going to abuse whatever you give them. This should have been figured out. And like, I'm sure it was just, the other thing to remember is Microsoft, for all, you know, I think you could, they're somewhere in the Twitter universe in that they've made a ton of great, farther along, they made a ton of great steps and a lot of great moves that are very encouraging, but they still have some real existential questions, one of which is they have no idea how to make money from consumers. I think they're like, wait, we're spending a lot. And for all the talk about cloud storage going to zero, it's still very, very expensive. I mean, you look at Box's numbers and how much it costs to support freemium users.
Interesting.
Cost is not zero.
Interesting.
And so I'm sure they were losing a lot of money on this.
Yeah.
And it was a screw up. And hopefully there's accountability for it.
I love Peter Bright's headline in Ars Technica. Microsoft drops unlimited OneDrive storage after people use it for unlimited storage.
And that was a weird thing because that was also all their messaging too. I remember when
they wanted you to do that.
When they're pitching OneDrive too, they're like, oh, you know, we're going to zero. It just gets cheaper every year for us to do this. Right. So this is why I spoke to people on the OneDrive team who gave me that exact pitch when they're telling me about these updates.
I think Ben nailed it. The marketing team did not talk to finance. I think you're exactly right.
Which is a terrible mistake to make. I mean, it's
because it really is just about marketing. It's about getting people to sign up for other paid programs so they get the benefit of the unlimited OneDrive. So it really is just a marketing tool. It has no real value to the business.
I don't know. It was a big screw up.
It might. I mean, you could make the argument. I mean, that getting people to use more Microsoft services and to move off things like Google Drive and Amazon might help Microsoft. Holistically, must have been very expensive.
Yeah, I wonder if they were looking to, I'll probably say that if you use Microsoft products, you have unlimited storage.
That's essentially it.
I mean, you know, then they should totally do it, right? Like,
well,
if I'm using Microsoft Office,
that was the deal. If you paid for Office, you got unlimited storage. That was the deal.
Yeah, I think it was Office 365.
Which I paid for it, $8 a month, and I got unlimited. Now, the real problem here is it's a communication error because the truth is you still have a terabyte, and for most people, that is unlimited storage, at least unlimited cloud storage. That's a ton.
One terabyte is totally reasonable. Like it was a 100% screw up.
Yeah,
like they got so in love with the unlimited talk that they screwed up what was a great opportunity. Giving 1 terabyte effectively unlimited is a great offer. And yes, it doesn't ring quite as wonderfully in your marketing pitch. But this goes like, I question, it really makes me wonder about the organizational structure. I know that sounds super geeky and stuff that people don't care about, but how does this happen? Like that you have this, what should have been a strength and a compelling offering is now become a black eye. I mean, it's pretty terrible. I mean, I think it's not going to be that big a deal in the long run. This stuff blows over.
Right.
But I don't understand how this happens in a couple. I do understand how it happens. I don't, but it doesn't make it any worse than
it could have a lasting impact because, well, of course, Google's gotten away with this time and time again. When you close down something people rely on.
Yeah, but Google's not asking people to pay for it. Like, right. It's a trust issue. And the fact of the matter is Microsoft is asking people to pay money. And this was for a paid service.
Right.
Like, you had to be an Office 365 subscriber. And so that makes it much worse because to get someone to pay for something is such a challenge already. And it requires a certain degree of trust and they betrayed that. And that's when Google, at the end of the day, is giving you something for free, and you can't really complain when they take it away.
Anything else you guys want to talk about? We can wrap this up. Om, are you satisfied? Have you got you've gotten everything? It's gone from light not day to night in your apartment.
Yeah,
I think it's bedtime for Om.
No, it's just time to, you know,
do something else.
Work.
What do you do? What do you do for, what does that mean when you say actually work? Like, what are you going to do? Do you like have a stack of papers on your desk you're going to go through?
No, you know, it's 21st century. You do everything on the computer.
I think you're going to be going through Lightroom looking for more great Instagram posts. That's what I think you're going to be doing. I love the pictures you're posting lately. Just some great stuff. And is this all Leica stuff? Or I love the black and white. Look at that.
This is all Fuji X-T1.
Oh, you were using the X-T1. Yeah. That is a nice little camera, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, I've been enjoying using that. This one is a Leica Q.
This is a Leica, yeah.
But I do want to sell my Leica Q. I don't like it very much.
It's too hard.
No, it's like 28 millimeter is a difficult lens for me to.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What do you have on the X-T1? What are you using on the X-T1?
I'm using 50mm.
Perfect. The native prime, as they say.
And I use 35mm on my Leica Classic.
Great stuff. I love the black and white.
Yeah. Am has an amazing Instagram account. So
you got to follow him.
I don't follow that many on Instagram because I actually do try to look at every picture, but one of my favorites for sure.
See, my Instagram is all about no people.
That's good because I'm sick of people, as you are.
No selfies.
Enough.
Well, you were doing the portrait series for a little bit, though.
Yeah, you and Chris Michael do the portrait stuff. And there's Chris himself. Actually, he's going to be on Twig, I think, this week.
Nice.
Yeah. He's an interesting fella.
Yeah.
Smart guy. We used to get him on the new screen or the old screensavers to talk about military.com. One, I guess that was his first startup. Yeah, no selfies. What the hell's wrong with you?
Not that important.
Man, don't you have any ego? Thank you, Om. It's always great to have you. Om.co. That's the place to go.
I appreciate that.
He's the Yoda of tech.
And looking like him, too.
You're cuddly. That's good. That's cuddly. I want to thank Ben Thompson, as always, for joining us. It's really a pleasure. Ben, as you can tell, has a really sharp intellect and thinks about this stuff harder than most of us, except for Om and Steve. So,
no, I'm super pumped about Om. I mean, Om was kind of the original when it comes to
no kidding.
Building.
Dude, I'm still here.
Deep thought. He is the original.
He hasn't gone anywhere.
I didn't say
it was gone. I just said no. One of my personal sort of.
I love Ben's stuff.
I know.
It's fun.
So. Great guys. And Steve, you and I will just sit in the corner here talking about
gadgets
and stuff. I'm pretty
excited. Speaking of selfies, I believe that Steve Kovach was featured in a how to make a superior selfie for Tinder article.
Yes, I was. Yeah.
Steve.
That's what we should be talking about.
Steve, is that on Tech? Where is that? Is that on Tech Insider?
Tech Insider. My colleague was doing. She talked to a Tinder consultant or something, and they used mine, some photos of mine of what not to do.
You're the before.
You had some favorable ones, I think.
Here it is. 10, 10 do's and don'ts.
It is.
For your dating profile photos. Same person. You can go both ways. Oh.
There's a handsome guy.
I would swipe what is it, right? Swipe right?
Swipe right means yes, yeah.
Yeah, I'd swipe right.
Hey Steve, how is your Tinder game?
I don't use Tinder. I don't like Tinder.
Tinder is so fascinating as a business because the traditional problem with dating sites, which IAC is the only company that's really figured out anyway, but the biggest problem with them is kind of related to our Amazon discussion is they have bad lifetime value because they don't get repeat customers, right? If you help two people get married, the problem is then they're no longer your customers. You have to get new customers.
Tinder doesn't worry about that. There's always another hookup
Tinder's
around the corner.
Modern value proposition.
Yeah. We're not worried about long-term relationships here.
it's quite interesting, actually. And the fact they're monetizing through in-app purchases and not advertising is actually...
How do they monetize? They just... Do you buy stuff?
Like a $20 super like thing and...
Super like?
Yeah. Yeah, there's like some ads.
You're limited by the number of swipes you can do in a day, I think, without it. And I think there's an undo function. AAC just filed
They need an undo function because I think it's probably a problem that you accidentally swipe left from time to time. I'm just thinking. But
and then it's a paid upgrade and it's like $20 a month subscription.
Whoa. Wow.
That is way too much.
Wow.
I'll just stay single forever. I'm not
thinking about it. This is a great service where everybody denies they use it. It's like, wait, like how is it so big that if everybody
uses
Tinder?
Yeah. Well, I'm happily married. I don't need to use it. Thank God.
I really don't use it. Look, I can show you my phone.
Look, it's nothing. There's no Tinder on there. Tinder. It's a Tinder-free phone.
It's not on there.
One phone.
Wait, that looks like Grindr. What is that? Oh, no, never mind.
No, that's my gym app.
Oh, that's sad. Steve Kovach is deputy editor at techinsider.io. Do you get a little deputy badge with that?
I wish.
You should get a badge.
Just make one.
Yeah. Make a badge. I'm the deputy here.
I think you guys should bring back the newspaper boy hats. Everybody should wear them. With your a little... deputy badge or whatever. I think all like BuzzFeed, Vice, everybody should be wearing it. Go retro. They could be the skinny jeans of 2016.
You know, I just realized that the big data breach is going to be when Tinder gets breached, right? Because
you can't tell.
You don't know if somebody's using Tinder or not, right? There's no way to know that. Well, I mean, like, I can't find out if...
Yeah, I guess not.
But at some point, like Ashley Madison... In fact, I bet you hackers are working on this right now, this thorny problem. The Tinder data breach.
And those cats are probably going to get really interesting.
Oh.
Imagine that.
Oh. Yikes.
You're worried, Leo. What's going on?
No, I'm not worried at all. Although my wife did that, my wife told me.
I'm not worried at all either.
I'm not. Why are you zooming in on me? I am not. Let's just swipe that. My wife did tell me that she did check the Ashley Madison database. So maybe I should worry. No, I never. If I signed up for Tinder, it was merely for
research.
Research.
Market research. Yeah.
Market research. Hey, it's been a lot of fun. You guys are great. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Leo.
We'll see you next time. And for all of you who joined us live, thank you for being here. We do the show 3 p.m. Pacific, 6 p.m. Eastern, 2300 UTC. If you want to watch live, I'd love it if you do. You can join us in the chat room, irc.twit.tv. If you'd like to be in studio with us, we always have a great time, and you're more than welcome. Just email us ahead of time. We'll put a chair out for you. Tickets at twit.tv. Happy birthday, David. He's here for his 50th. A reminder that tomorrow, the author of Cyberphobia, Edward Lucas, will be my guest on Triangulation. If you missed the new screensavers yesterday, Jason Howell and Scott Wilkinson co-hosted because I was out of town. You did a great job, too.
Thanks.
Yeah.
It was a lot of fun.
Talked about 8-stem, new high-end loudspeaker, and we interviewed the creator of the Steam Carnival. Actually, I did that one. Yep. Next Saturday, Ian Thompson will be joining us as a co-host on the new screensavers. I hope you'll stop by. Thanks for joining us, and we'll see you next time. Another twit is in the can.